Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
To our May 1st meeting, and before we begin, I'd like to ask Commissioner Sutton if he would do our invocation and pledge for us today.
If we could take a moment, please. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for another opportunity to have one of the greatest rights free people can have, the right of self-governance. Be with us this day for our budget hearings. Be with us as we go through the budget process. Help us all to be open-minded and fair and be balanced with our judgments. Please be with our government, our White House, our Defense Department, as they face, no doubt, some of the most daunting tasks that we've ever faced in this world. Amen.
Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. All right, this morning, public speakers, and I think we have one, Tony Cox.
And that document was confusing, because there's with y'all just changing back and forth. Don't know if it's agenda item, public comment, blah, blah, blah. But that's consistent. People are here for money. I'm here for money, too. What I would like is $26,280,000. Mine started on a sliding scale from $3,700 up to, so the number's $26,280,000. If you ask the question, why is Tony Cox here? And what did you do? Why and what did you do? I can go through it, but it's still going to be the same. Still going to be the same from y'all. My president, Mr. Donald Trump, my name's Tony Cox. I live in Alamance County, North Carolina. People in this room have been committing crimes against me for well over 10 years now. And I don't know what to do other than you say that you are here to help me. I'm looking for your help. My Congressman Mark Walker refuses. State Representatives Rick Gunn, Dennis Rydell, and Steve Ross fail me. This Board of Commissioners fails me. There is, to start with, you can go to mail fraud. Now, I've seen people in federal prison that are there for mail fraud. I've seen one just for sending a letter to President Bush talking about gay people. And he was there in federal prison for that. Mail fraud. That is the beginning. This board, some of you that are here now, some of you that's been here, in 2011, I think it was, I proved beyond a reasonable doubt that the Alamance County High Impact Land Use and Polluting Industries Ordinance was a farce. Okay? With the admission of wrongdoing and the adoption and enforcement of that law. The person that started it with me, Larry Shambly, stood at this podium right here and lied. Eddie Boswell, the chairman, said that he had spoken to Mr. Shambly, but it didn't stop there. It could have been, I'm sorry, let's fix this. We messed up. King Auto Salvage was still available to me for $2 million. Mr. President, I need your help. Because everybody else, they come to these boards, councils, and commissions, and they sit there, and everybody looks pretty, and they do their little prayers, but they don't care. That's the biggest problem with our society today, is people don't care. They let it go on and on and on. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan. All right. Any commissioner responses?
I'd like to say hello to the president.
Hello, president. All right. Now, how about approval of our agenda for the morning?
I make a motion we approve the agenda.
Thank you.
I'll second it.
Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Consent agenda, is there anything there that we would like to pull that questions on? Hearing none, can I get a motion to approve?
I make a motion we approve the consent agenda.
Thank you, Amy.
I'll second that.
Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right. Presentations. This morning we have Susan Roberts is going to work with us, I guess you and Todd, maybe. I don't know how.
We're going to present separately this morning, commissioners. Good morning. Before you this morning is a request for the county to pull down $453,687.10 from state lottery funds to be used in accordance with the Memorandum of Understanding for the fiscal year 16-17 debt service payment for the Career Tech Center. When that building was constructed, the county and the Board of Ed agreed to use a percentage of state lottery funds for the debt service payment, and this is the portion that we need for the fiscal year.
What balance does that leave us? I'm sorry.
That will leave us, and I don't have that exact number in front of me this morning. I actually worked that up earlier. But I can get that exact number for you, commissioners, of what we are actually owed on that Career Tech Center.
I didn't mean the balance, that balance. I meant the balance of the lottery funds.
Oh, I'm sorry. Balance of the lottery funds. It would still be around slightly less than $2 million.
I'd like to know the balance of the Tech Center.
I can get that for you.
Original and what it is today.
Okay, absolutely.
Any other questions? Okay. I'd like to make a motion that we approve this.
Second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right, next we have Dr. Todd Thorpe with the school system.
Good morning, Chairman Boswell, commissioners. I've actually got two things on my list today. I want to return $69,562.63 back to the lottery pot. We finished these projects and closed out these projects, and request $65,000 for carpet removal and an awning.
And what schools is that?
The carpet removal for this one's Broadview and BEJ for the awning.
Is the return just because when it was bid out, it's like up to a certain maximum amount? The actual cost up to a certain amount or something?
Oh, a lot of times, like when the paint contracts, we have a little additional added into the paint because you don't know how much, for sure, how many gallons it's going to take. A lot of times with the carpet, when we have carpet removal, it's a price and they don't know what's under the carpet. So there's another price there in case we have to do any remediation under the carpet before we put the tile down. Many times there's not, but I'd rather have the money in reserve than come up short on a project.
Do you happen to know what area Broadview the carpet is to be removed?
In the office areas.
The office areas?
We've got our money's worth out of that carpet.
I'm sure. I have the opportunity to tour Broadview briefly and saw some of the capital needs that they have. And so I'm glad y'all are going to do some work over there.
Yes, ma'am. We've got several things on the agenda this summer for over there.
I'm sure.
I move approval.
Okay. Thank you, Bob.
A second.
Thank you, Amy. Any other questions? All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you,
Dr. Thorpe. All right. Next, I'm guessing, Brian, you're going to do the approval to accept grant funds for recreation and parks.
Absolutely. Good morning, commissioners. I'm
one of the people here not asking for money today, so happy to be before you.
Welcome.
I'm seeking permission to accept a grant from Impact Alamance in the amount of $40,000. This is a joint project between our department and the school system at Pleasant Grove Community Center, and it is going to expand and really improve the walking track that we have there. It is the most popular feature of Pleasant Grove Community Center. It will go from a couple hundred feet to about two-thirds of a mile with help from Impact Alamance. So this is the fourth grant we've got from Impact Alamance, and they're getting close to $250,000, so they've helped us out quite a bit.
That's terrific. I'm familiar with the Pleasant Grove area because I've been a Union Ridge girl. I go over there sometimes and played ball or basketball when my child did, not me. So that's great. I'm glad to hear they've given some attention.
It's a great project, yeah.
I'd like to just point out, Impact Alamance has done a lot for this county. We rode out to Benevolence Farm yesterday. They bought equipment that they can use on the farm out there, and they're making a difference in our community, and I just want to thank them.
Yeah, I agree. That's why I brought it up. This project has been on our wish list for a very long time, but quite honestly wasn't looking like it was something we were going to be able to do. But they've been a huge help.
They've stepped up to a lot of people.
I move approval.
Okay.
Second.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Thank you. Family Justice Center Intake Specialist.
Yes. Good morning.
Hello there.
So I come before you today to ask, it's just a kind of a refurbishing of a grant we have from Governor's Crime Commission. And when we wrote the grant, we didn't have this front reception position to be there on the door. We thought we could kind of spread it out between several of the different positions within the Family Justice Center, but we have found that we need that position. We've written the job description and sent it to our funder at the Governor's Crime Commission. They have approved it. So I just need to establish the position, and it will be funded by Governor's Crime Commission. We're about halfway through the first year of a two-year grant with the Governor's Crime Commission, and we'll re-up for two more years. So this position would not be, would not stay if we can't fund it. But it's the intake position, the person that walks in the door, it's the intake specialist.
Have you not had any?
We have not. Okay. So we had another grant, and we used that person that way. But as Commissioner Byrd knows, we recently attended the Family Justice Center Alliance meeting.
I was
going
to speak to that, yeah.
Do you want to speak to
sure.
that?
Yeah.
Sure.
They're anonymous from Alamance County. Actually took the sheriff's place. He was supposed to go, but then he couldn't. And so I'm so privileged and honored that I did, because I learned so much about what goes on in Family Justice Centers, not just here, but across the country. And this position is really a best practice. They emphasize that the intake person is the most important person in your Family Justice Center, and it needs to be somebody who's dedicated to that position, somebody who has the interpersonal skills to really put the client at ease and get the information from the client that's needed to be able to service that client without feeling like they're being interrogated and, you know, just checking off a checklist. I mean, it's just critical to the success of the program.
So there's no county money in this position, and we have the approval from the funder to establish the position and use those funds.
Great. Well, I make a motion that we create that position.
Thank you, Amy.
I'll second that.
Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
All right.
Great. Thank you so much.
Okay, we're going to switch a fire district here. Let's see.
Good morning, Chairman, Commissioners. Memphis Fire Department built a new fire department on Memphis Oaks Road several years ago. And there was this area on Turner Road that was not in Swepsonville's 5-mile district. It was outside. So Swepsonville's ISO rating is a 6. They were getting charged a 9S because they were not within 5 miles from the fire department. A couple residents called the fire marshal's office and wanted to know what they had to do because they were about 3 miles from Memphis Fire Department. So the board from Swepsonville met, the board from Memphis met, and they wanted to change the district. Swepsonville agreed to give it up to Mevin to get the homeowners insurance to drop significantly for that area. I contacted Vernon Ward with the North Carolina Department of Insurance, and he said I had to have two-thirds approval from the area out there saying they wanted to change to Mevin. And the easiest way to do that was to send a letter or if I thought they would not understand it, go door to door and explain it to them, show them the map. So I spent about three Saturdays, a couple nights going out there. I got about 90 some signatures for approval out of 120. I contacted Vernon back at the state. Marlena drew some maps. We sent them to the state. As you can see, the dark purple area is the area in question. It will be moved to Mebane if y'all approve of it. The fire tax rate based on a $150,000 house, I think that's about the medium range out there. Swepsonville, their fire tax rate is $135. By moving to Mebane, it will go up about $22 on a $150,000 house. This is just estimated purposes. DOI said their insurance will drop 35% to 45% per year. So $800 insurance policy would drop to between $440 to $520 per year. So they're on board. If we can get approved by y'all today, it will go back to DOI, and they're saying probably 30 to 60 days it will be moved to Mebane's fire district. So if they call 911, Mebane would be responding out there.
Okay. And this tax increase deal, the change in that, will that, Susan, will that come about during this year's tax?
Yes, the fire process. Departments who have requested a tax increase, they will be here next meeting,
right,
to discuss that as well.
So these folks would actually kind of be considered as Mebane?
And yes, they would fall under Mebane at this
limits,
point in time.
The fire,
right,
the fire,
right,
district.
Okay. Randall's Mill Creek.
City of Mebane. Just on the other side.
Just the Orange County part? I mean, excuse me, Alamance County part? Or what about the
Orange County area? Still has an area on the back part of Mill Creek subdivision where if they call 911, ambulance from Alamance does not respond to Orange County unless it's mutual aid if they're out of trucks, but they would, Mebane would come as EMT or first responders, and the ambulance would come from Orange County and come through Alamance to get to the backside of Mill Creek.
Just one entrance there.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Of course, the developers do
there's
that.
There's two entrances, one off Kate's, or I'm sorry, Miss White's Lane going to the backside, and it's also the main entrance off 119.
Are those both Alamance?
Yes, sir.
Entrances?
Yes, sir.
So the developer knew that when they put it out there and when the planners looked at it. So, but I'd just like to let you answer.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other questions?
So if somebody lives in Orange County and they dial 911?
It's a few areas on the backside of Mill Creek that are actually in Orange County.
Yeah, yes, so if one of those residents dialed 911?
An ambulance from Orange County is coming.
So does it go to Orange County CCOM or to our CCOM?
I'm not sure.
Yeah. It goes to Orange County CCOM. Okay. We've been having discussions with Orange County about switching those residents of Mill Creek to come to Alamance County CCOM and then have some interlocal agreement where Alamance County EMS would respond. But I think we started those discussions with Orange County, it's been some time ago. So the idea was Alamance County EMS may be able to respond quicker and get to them faster than Orange.
But folks at the fire department can respond,
they should respond
no matter
yes,
what.
Yes.
It switches. A lot of times that's the
right.
First responder there is the one that really gets things started. So. Any other questions?
Well, if that's what they, I'd be happy to make
a motion. We'll give it to them, right? Thank you, Bob. I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Okay, next we have our budget presentation from outside agencies. At the request of Mr. Lashley, he wanted everybody here today, but unfortunately he didn't make these. You're
me
having fun. Tim suggests
he's
we make him watch it on the video. Anyhow, thanks to everyone that is here from outside agency. We do appreciate you coming today, and I'm just going to go down the list here of those that are asking for money from the county, and let you just come forward, introduce yourself, and tell us a little bit about what you do. Keep it to a little bit, because we have a whole lot. So, and I'm going to begin with Adult Daycare Friendship Center.
I don't believe they're going to be here, Mr. Chairman. They're actually a grant, total grant funded, so
totally
they won't receive
okay,
any county
so
money.
Okay. How about Alamance Community Services Agency? Here we go. Okay. Good morning.
Good morning.
Chairman Boswell.
How are you?
And Commissioners. My name is Annette Orbit, and I'm the Executive Director of Alamance County Community Services Agency. That's a long title, ACCSA. I've been there 8 months. And what we are requesting is $65,500 to help support our congregate nutrition program for the elderly. The program provides hot, nutritious meals for seniors age 60 and older. I just had a birthday, so I'm in that range now. That makes me feel good. And we provide hot meals 5 days a week. During that time, we have 120 to 160 seniors, and we have four different locations in Alamance County. Well, we also provide, other than the meals, we do crafts, we have speakers, we do nutrition classes, trying to get them on healthy eating programs. Currently, we have a wait list of about 47 people waiting to get into the program. This program has been in existence for almost 20 years. And we have 320 active seniors in the program. The funds would help us with the cost of food. As you know, food cost is rising. Maintenance for the equipment. We have warmers. We need a new refrigerator. It seems like everything breaks at the same time. We also need some office equipment. It would help give our site managers an increase in their salaries. And we the seniors are telling us this is the only hot meal that they get, a lot of them. And a lot of them are really worried that they're going to lose this meal. So it would help us provide more for them. We asked them to pay $1.50 per meal, and a lot of them can't even do that. So it is a tough situation. So we're just requesting and asking you for your consideration for this grant.
Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
All right.
Appreciate it. Any questions for that?
I will say I was your board chairman for about 5 years,
right,
and on
yes.
the board for maybe 10 or something.
Yes.
And this is a very valuable program.
Yes.
Appreciate you doing it.
Thank you.
Where are the four sites now?
We have one in Graham at the Graham Recreation, and one at Burlington Homes, and one at John Robert Knodel.
Thanks. All right. Alamance County Meals on Wheels.
Good morning. I'm Amanda Bartolomeo, and I'm the Executive Director of Meals on Wheels. And this year we are currently seeking $70,000. And we really depend on these funds to be able to continue providing home-delivered meals to the elderly homebound in our county. This is a very conservative amount for us that we're requesting, because we know that there's a lot of resourceful programs in our county that need the funds as well. These funds are very critical for our agency that help to fill the gap in our budget, as well as a match for the HCCBG grant. Currently, we have 340 clients and about 110 on our waiting list, and this is due to budget limitations. Our list continues to grow every day. We receive referrals on a regular basis, and the list really is in high demand, especially in the Hall River, Mebane, and southern parts of the county. Investing in Meals on Wheels has been shown to save the taxpayer money by lowering hospital costs and nursing home readmission fees. The program is a combination of well-balanced nutrition, a safety check, and a friendly visit, which offers the complete package to our seniors, which helps to keep them healthier, being more independent by staying in their homes for as long as possible. So we feel that Meals on Wheels is a win-win for our seniors and their families and the community as well. We really depend on these funds to be able to continue providing meals to our seniors. And also on our part, we continue to offer fundraisers on a regular basis throughout the year and to apply for other grants as available. We also interview the clients every 6 months to make sure they're still qualified, so we only put on really the neediest clients in our county to really keep the list down to be able to serve as many people as possible. This year we've had a lot of uncertainty as far as our federal funds. We're anticipating that we will be impacted, but at this point we really don't know the extent until the federal budget is passed. So this year, more than others, we're really depending heavily upon other funding opportunities for our agency. And again, we will continue to host as many fundraisers and apply for other grants as possible. So again, we really appreciate your support for our agency, not only financially, but also volunteering and the events that we offer throughout the year. We really appreciate your support in coming out and helping us with those opportunities.
Thank you, Amanda.
So you have, it's the rubber duck
Yes, so that's one of our main ones that we offer every year, and it's during the Carousel Festival. So we'll have that one again this year. We do a Christmas card. We did Mother's Day, Father's Day this year. So we're trying to add some other ones, but not to bombard the community all the time, but trying to space it out a little bit.
So I was invited by one of Amanda's board members to actually deliver meals one day. What's the day called?
Community Champions Day.
Community Champions Day this year and last year, too, and it's very interesting to go door to door and see the conditions of these folks that really need this service.
Yep. And we appreciate you coming out that day.
It's a good service, without a doubt. And you're so right that a lot of folks wouldn't be able to stay at home without coming into the house.
I just had a quick question. It's $70,000. Have y'all been receiving money from the county in the past, or is this?
We have. So we're currently receiving $58,425.
Okay, thank you.
And that's been a long time, I think.
It has. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks. All right. Next, we have the Alamance County Transportation Authority. Mr. Ralph Gill.
Good morning, Commissioner Boswell and other commissioners. I'm Ralph Gillum. I'm the executive director for Alamance County Transportation Authority. We have been in business since 2002 when we were established by the county commissioners. And we provide transportation services for anyone in Alamance County. We usually run around 70,000 trips, one-way trips annually. We provide services for elderly and disabled as well as general public. We take people to medical appointments. We take them shopping. We take them to schools, Alamance Community College, Elon University, and almost any other general purpose trip. We also do a lot of transportation for dialysis patients in Alamance County. We are requesting $144,265 for the upcoming year. The package that we put together for you shows that we are totally supported by grants, either state or federal grants, that come up to about $1,995,000. And the local match, which we're asking for the commissioners, comes up to the $144,000. Most of the people that use our services are in very much need of transportation. They either don't have cars or they don't have access to reliable transportation in many cases. There are others that prefer not to drive, and so we're there. If you're in a point in Alamance County, we'll go to that point, pick you up at your point, and then we deliver you to your destination. And that's direct service versus a fixed route service that goes just in a circular pattern. We recently moved to a zone scheduling process to improve our efficiency, and that is making good headways for us. But we basically broke Alamance County into 9 zones, and we published our availability schedule for those zones, and you're in. Your zone is based on your home address. And we have about 4,000 riders that are registered in our system. I think this past year we took between 600 and 700 different individuals running about 70,000 trips. And the only other thing I would add to our request is we will need to continue with the funding advances that we have set up in prior years due to just the need for operating funds and the delay in getting grant reimbursements. We've asked for $250,000 from the county to be advanced so that we can continue to operate, and then we pay those funds back to the county when we get reimbursement. And then the other thing is to continue to provide for occupancy for our organization, which is building and parking space.
Were y'all going to relocate, or did that never come?
I think we're in a building on Martin Street that the county's looking at, and we did do some searching, but we didn't really locate something that was suitable.
Right.
We can continue to do that process, but as of right now, we're still kind of waiting on the county to see what holds in the future.
And what are the fares to ride?
The fares are $3 for a one-way trip. That's for general public.
Okay.
And, you know, an average trip probably costs us about $20, $21. So the grant is used to offset the difference.
Down.
Yeah. And, you know, from a funding standpoint, it would be nice if we could build reserves, but in the grant situation, you cannot really earn, you can't make a profit off those grants. The only way we can make a profit is through our contract business, which we do some, but here again, building a profit is pretty difficult over time. So we operate year to year and generally break even.
So I should disclose, I'm representing the Board of Commissioners
right.
on Ralph's board for the last 2.5 years, and I've been Secretary Treasurer, I think, all that time.
Correct.
And he's right about the cash flow needs, because the grants, when he does a trip, he doesn't get paid for it for months later, particularly on the federal grant for the urban trips. So it's sometimes 9 or 10 or more months before you get paid. So.
Well, that seems to be a good working relation between the county and you guys to possibly fund you up front for keeping things rolling.
Yep. So. Unless the county wants to just give us the money, but no. we're fine with the advance.
We'll keep going the way we're going. That works well.
I say that sometimes people don't remember the rural people and the problems that they have with transportation as a rural resident. You know, people who can get very isolated. And if you don't have family around to give you a lift to town, it can be hard. You can't just call an Uber sometimes or rely on another way to get around. So ACTA, I think, really fills an important role for rural people in helping them to stay at home and get to the doctor, get to the grocery store, and so forth.
Absolutely.
And I think that's the main reason why ACTA's, I mean, there's active organizations throughout the state, and most counties or a lot of counties.
Yes.
And I think the emphasis for them starting was for that rural transportation.
And you guys can also connect with the PART program and do paratransit if you need it.
We do. We connect with PART every day at the Graham Park and Ride and pick up people in Alamance County, deliver them there, and they move on to Chapel Hill. We can also do the same thing with Triangle Transit out of when they come to Mebane.
All right. Any more questions, Tim? Okay, any questions? Thank you, Ralph,
okay.
very much.
Thank you.
Alamance Elder Care. Laura Reagan. Good morning.
Chairman, thank you, Commissioners, for seeing us. Laura Reagan from Alamance Elder Care. Alamance Elder Care has been in the county and active in the county since 1994 when it came together as part of Planning Committee for Services to the Elderly and Alamance Regional Medical Center. As my colleagues before me have discussed, obviously there's a growing need in this county for services for the elderly. Between 2010 and 2010, the population of Alamance County increased by 15%, or just over 15%. But the population of those aged 60 and over increased by almost 30%. For those ages 60 to 64, the growth rate was 61%. By 2030, the population of persons aged 65 to 74 in this county will increase by 65%. And 42% of older adults aged 60 and over have some kind of disability, whether that's vision, hearing, an ambulatory disability. So there's a great need. Alamance Elder Care does not charge for its services. We provide first and foremost, information and referral to services out in the community. So we are constantly referring to a lot of the colleagues that have spoken before me. We provide care management, and that is working one-on-one with a frail older adult in monitoring them, at first assessing them, monitoring them, creating a plan of care for them, reassessing them, and making sure that the services that they have are appropriate for them. We are providing options counseling, helping seniors to make a plan of care for themselves, and they're the client in that situation, and determine what long-term care supports they're going to need going forward. We are contracted through the Department of Social Services. We provide community alternatives program for disabled adults for all persons who qualify, and that's a skilled level nursing care level in the home, and we provide that for everybody 60 and over for the County of Alamance. And this past year, we have started a lot of health and wellness programming, and these are evidence-based programs. We've been working on a matter of balance, which really teaches seniors how they're going to fall, how to fall safely. We've been working on a chronic disease self-management program, which helps seniors to manage their chronic disease, and powerful tools for caregivers. And we believe all three of these programs enable seniors to have less visits to the emergency room department, and less admissions into the hospital, and less admissions, therefore, into rehab centers, less admissions into assisted living. So we feel like we contribute to the county in saving those costs overall. This past year, Alamance Elder Care went through a strategic planning process. We revised our mission statement, which is now states that we want a community in which all older adults and their caregivers have access to the resources and supports that they need to live full and independent lives. And we feel like that really meshes well with the county's pillar for public safety and health. So we are asking to maintain the $86,100 that the county awarded us last year. We are the grants that we received through Older American Act funding and the billable units that we received through the CAPBA program do not in any way fund the salaries of our agency. So we do also have to have a lot of fundraising. We have an annual breakfast each fall, a couple of golf tournaments. We've got one coming up in June, and our Super Bowl, and those have been our mainstay fundraisers. So we appreciate what the county has done for us in the past, and we just ask that it continue.
Any questions?
I should know. I've been on Laura's board for about 10 or 15 years now.
You have another life.
It's all about service.
That's right.
One thing I just want to emphasize is that what the agency does for supporting caregivers. And if you've ever had a loved one have dementia, I mean, when that starts to unfold and you think, gosh, what do I do? Where do I go for help? Alamance Elder Care is the starting point, and then they come and assess and can really get the right resources that you need for you. But then they do a lot of education around how to live with somebody with dementia. It was real helpful to my wife and I when we were experiencing that in our family. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Now, are we going to in-home aid, or are those just grant
In-home aid and Office of Juvenile Justice are complete grant funds, so
okay,
they will
so
not be here.
Art Association of Alamance County, that would be Kerry.
And just before Kerry starts, just for the benefit of the board, the next several presenters are all funded by occupancy tax, and these are funds collected by the county that we are required by law to spend on tourism-related functions. Two-thirds of the tax that we collect goes to the TDA, and the rest we divvy out to organizations that you'll hear from now.
So. Bring people to Alamance County, is that
correct.
Right?
Thank you. I'm Kerry Worthy, Director of Alamance Arts, and we are requesting funds from those taxes. We just finished a great year this year with bringing in Chihuly, the Venetians. We had 27,000 people come through our facility in 3 months. We had all 50 states, 27 countries, So we felt that it was a great program, and it definitely made an impact on Alamance County. Coming up in our new budget will be, every other year we do the Willow Walk, and it brings in sculptures from all over the region. And from those, then we tried to purchase pieces and created our public art project, where we've already have 35 sculptures throughout Alamance County that we have presented from that project. So everything we do, even though it's aimed at the residents of Alamance County, it also assists us in bringing in people from surrounding areas. Do you have any questions?
I remember the little mouse you guys moved around.
That's correct.
My grandkids, they loved that. It was like, let's go find the mouse.
Right. Yes. Artie the mouse is around Graham.
So another disclosure.
Guess what?
I used to be on Carrie's board for 10 or 15 years. I don't know how, but now my wife is on Carrie's board. So.
That's correct.
Very good. Thank you, Carrie,
right,
for what y'all do in bringing people to the county.
I just want to emphasize for those listening and for the citizens, sometimes, you know, I get questions, why do these people or those people get money from the county? And I just really wanted to be clear that those people who get money from the occupancy tax, that is not money that could go to education or the sheriff's department or the health department or DSS. The occupancy tax can only be used for organizations that have some kind of relation to tourism and bringing people into Alamance County. And so I think that's really, really important for the citizens to know and to understand that when Alamance Arts or any of these other organizations that we're talking about, when y'all give money, it's not taking money away from an essential core function of county government.
And nothing else, you've helped generate some of that.
And maybe the people that you bring in, maybe they stop at the bill down the street, or maybe get a cookout milkshake.
That's right.
They do, definitely. Thank you.
Thank you.
Carrie.
Appreciate it. All right, Historic Museum, Mr. William Vincent.
Good morning, folks.
Good morning.
My name is Bill Vincent. I'm the director of the Alamance County Historical Museum. And on behalf of the museum's board of directors, I certainly want to thank you all for the opportunity to be here this morning. During 2016, the museum experienced its 40th year of operation, and during this year in 2017, I will have been at the museum for 29 years, and little did I know when I succeeded Peggy Boswell as interim director in 1988 that the position would essentially become a career for me. For those of you who have had a chance to review our financial statements for the last year, you know that we ended the year in the black. We oversee an accessioned collection of materials relating to the county history that has a current value and actually exceeds $1,200,000. Most of that collection is, part of it is in storage, part of it is rotated out for temporary exhibits. In addition to that, we maintain a National Register historic property that has been repeatedly designated by the North Carolina Department of Cultural Resources as one of the best local museums in the state. Last year, with a staff of three, we gave personally guided tours of the site to over 14,000 visitors who came to us from all 50 states and 15 foreign countries. Our visitors included 20 school groups from elementary age through college age. We had 7 daycare groups that came out, 10 senior citizen groups, 10 book and garden clubs, 6 civic organizations, and so we reach a wide range of the population in terms of age. In addition to that, we allowed the museum to be used for 20 private rentals, and those of course help to generate some funds for our operation as well. We hosted a number of special events, lectures. These included topics ranging from the history of golf to the story of the Vanderbilt family and the life of Robert E. Lee. We hosted book signings for photographic author and local celebrity Jane Isley, as well as Tim Allen, whose new book, Slave Escapes and the Underground Railroad, contained much history about Alamance County. Noted archaeologist Dr. Linda Carnes McNaughton gave a fascinating program about the 18th and 19th century pottery traditions here in Alamance County. And if those of you who might be interested to know, we now know, based on her archaeology work, that so much of the early pottery that is included in the collections at MES, the Museum of Early Southern Decorative Arts in Winston-Salem, that has always previously been identified as Moravian pottery, we now know was made right here in southern Alamance County. And that's based upon, so it's led to a total reevaluation of that whole set of pottery traditions. In October of this past year, we produced a curated exhibit of over 40 local quilts from the 19th and early 20th century, and we had, in conjunction with that, a series of lectures by nationally recognized guest scholars. We hosted History Day for Leadership Alamance, as well as our annual Christmas tea and greenery sale. We had an annual spring garden tour, and we always do an American Doll tea for young girls here in the community as well. And in May, an episode of the PBS series The State of Music was filmed at the museum, and that will be broadcast sometime, I think, in the fall of this year on most PBS stations. Our publications, including The History of Alamance, Taste in Plaid, Shuttle and Plow, and The Biographical History of Alamance County, continue to be ongoing sources of revenue for the museum as well. Last year, we were fortunate enough to receive $82,000 in funding, and we hope that you feel that this was a justified investment. Nevertheless, these funds represent only about half of our budgeted expenses, and the balance of that we raise on an annual basis through membership support, through all these fundraising events that I've just alluded to, and through the sales of our books. Because our buildings on the grounds now are more than 225 years old, some of them, those buildings, the earliest date to about 1790, we have continuing maintenance problems with those buildings, and we had a number of issues to come up this year, which we were not expecting, that led to about $10,000 in expense that we weren't actually anticipating. Right now, we are facing some issues with the 19th century granary and corn crib building. Those two buildings were built in the 1870s by a local vernacular builder, and they are some of the more interesting, to me, buildings on the site because of their construction. And we have just received estimates that those two buildings need about $8,000 in stabilization and repairs. And so to this end, we are respectfully requesting a $2,000 increase this year in county in the funding over what we received in 2016-17. In other words, we're requesting $84,000 rather than the $82,000 that we received in the previous year. So I'll be happy to answer any questions if anyone has anything. And I do very much appreciate the support that we have been given from the county over these 40 years.
I was just out at your property yesterday. The Republican women had a tea there, and it's just lovely.
Well, thank you.
And people should really go out. If you haven't checked it out, people should go out and see the historical museum. And also, I'd like it if you would put me on your email list, because I didn't know about the stuff that y'all have been doing.
Okay. We'll
and be, I would like we'll to know more about to. In the future.
Thank you, Bill. Very
thank
much.
You. Thanks.
Okay, Parks and Rec.
Ron Baker's still here. He may have. He may not have realized that he was going to be asked to
speak. Yes, former Park and Rec director might know a little bit about
it.
He thought he was going to get you to stand up and do this.
And again, occupancy tax, we can use it on properties like parks, museums, so this is another approved use of occupancy tax.
I've got one little question on that. You know, we're doing a budget, okay? We don't really know what those taxes will be coming in. Are we just basing on this year's numbers?
What we've done is we've projected $777,000 in occupancy tax for 17-18. That's based on trends that we've seen in occupancy tax over the past couple of years. And then we allocate these funds out. Immediately, two-thirds of it will go to the CVB. That's where it must go. The rest we've allocated out to these organizations that we have traditionally funded. And we do have a small amount left over. I think we have about $49,000 that is unallocated. And what we will do with that is, as we see the year progress, if we're not bringing in occupancy tax as we projected, we'll keep that money, and hopefully that would cover any shortages.
So we have a little bit of a reserve.
Yes.
Because I know some of these agencies, like William, he's talking about needing 10,000 to fix buildings, and they're kind of making their budget off of us projecting something we really don't know.
Yes, and you know, if we have, let's say the occupancy tax comes in greater than we've projected, or that money is left, and at the end of the year we'll have to figure out how to divvy it out, because it must be spent on tourism-related functions. But as of right now, the way we have allocated is the way we plan to go forward with the funding. So,
I went to Mevin yesterday. There's a lot of hotels being built, so I'm guessing it's going to increase.
Yes.
So,
let me ask you a question. Could that tax build a convention center of any sort, or finance one?
Yes, I believe so. I'd have to double check the legislation for sure, but I believe it can be used to offset debt for those kind of constructions.
Okay. All right, now we'll have Brian Baker come forward and just give us a little update on Park and Rec.
Yes, nobody told me I was going to have to talk, but I'm not pointing any fingers there. So this is money that we don't allocate separately in our budget. What we ask for you guys is essentially like a general fund request, and this offsets those funds, but we don't separately budget that as it goes up and down. So it's just part of everything we do at the Recreation and Parks Department. Okay.
Stay close by. I think you're down on the next
I'll be here.
Tourism.
Yep. Thank you.
Party.
Yes, you can. You can use that for, you can use it for debt if you'd like for constructing a
civic center. How long a section is that, by the way? I'm just curious.
It's a 1987 session, House Bill 2207. So it's only about two.
Can we get a copy of it? Yes. All of us get a copy of it?
Sure, sir.
All right. Sword of Peace.
Hi.
Morning.
Good morning. My name is Ed Whitehead. I am the new producing artistic director of the Snow Camp Outdoor Theater, but my association with Snow Camp has been about 18 of the last 30 years. So I've had a long experience first as an actor, then as a director, and now coming back as producing artistic director. The Snow Camp Outdoor Theater serves a couple of purposes that that we think are very valuable to the community. One, we bring in people from all over the world, which is to hear our stories of peace, our stories of coming to an understanding among different races, different classes of people, to you know, to understand that we are all part of, you know, the human experience, and to encourage people to reach out and try to understand people that are different from ourselves. We have made a lot of headway in that area. One of the kind of a side note, we were a question on Jeopardy one time, so we were proud of that. And we, you know, we want to continue telling these stories. Obviously, being in a very rural area, it is hard to find people, you know, to come out to Snow Camp. And some people from Burlington or Graham or any of the other communities say, "Well, I've heard of it, but I don't know exactly where it is," and trying to get people out there. But we have increased our attendance. We, you know, are keeping ourselves on track budget-wise. We hope to expand and do a little bit more. We think that this is an opportunity to work with the Convention and Tourism Bureau and bring in people, maybe continue past just a summer season and to do productions in the winter and spring in our indoor facilities. Many of our structures need lots of work, and as others have said, we have buildings that are 200 years old, and so it's really important that we get them preserved. So we appreciate the grants, the committee's previous support, and we look forward to your continued success.
Now, are the Wilsons still involved there with you in the
program? Yes. James Wilson's brother is now on the board, Brian Wilson, his son. So there are several of the Wilsons that are still involved in and play a major part in the theater.
They did a lot to get that going years and years ago. So, any other questions?
I'll just say, in case anybody missed the earlier part of the meeting, if you fast forward it on the video to see the Sword of Peace presentation, that this isn't money that takes away from the schools or other county departments. This is funded out of the occupancy tax, which can only be used for things like this, because I've been questioned about the Sword of Peace allocation too. So.
Right, well, and just one final thing is, one of the things that we strive to do, which goes into education but is not necessarily coming out of their budget, is we find that we have people who don't know what they want to do in life, and then high school kids, they come with work with us for a few seasons, then they say, I want a career in theater, or I want a career in the arts in some way, and so we think we serve a vital purpose that way.
That's good.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. All right. Next, we have Brian Baker again with Tourism Development Authority. I think he only knows your name. Is that okay?
Hi.
Hey, Grace.
Good morning, Chairman, Commissioners. My name is Grace Vandevisser, and I'm the Executive Director with the Convention and Visitors Bureau for the county, also known as the Tourism Development Authority. And many of you have already said much to what we are, but the authority is charged with promoting Alamance County and attracting visitors here, which have a great economic impact on our community beyond folks just stepping here and seeing an attraction or going to a ball game, visiting our parks. And so again, thank you to all of our partners that are here today. And as far as our budget, as you have mentioned, we are completely funded by the occupancy tax. 2/3 of that must come back to the Visitors Bureau, and those funds are used to market our community, our events, our attractions, and to get folks not just to come in for a day, but to stay overnight and get those occupancy taxes up and those sales up for our community. So we are asking for the amount is scheduled around $502,000 as our 2/3 used specifically to market tourism.
I believe you hosted about 1,000 cyclists here this past year.
We did. We were fortunate to have quite a few cyclists come through as part of Cycle NC this past fall. So it was a very smooth event. They do come through every few years, and we're fortunate. They either are held in Burlington or come through Burlington or Mebane. So it's been a successful event for us and for the state. In addition, just to make note, our TDA has a contract, an agreement with the county now that came about around September to oversee the staff, myself, and other individuals, as well as administrative for the CBB.
How are you promoting Alamance County?
We promote via our marketing, either digital advertising. We also promote by going to different types of shows, whether they're group related, they might be sports related, leisure. We do a lot of on digital would be Facebook or Instagram, magazines. Those are some of the outlets. And of course, then we work with our partners as well. We distribute a lot of promotional material, always looking to package. So there's, you know, got to be a lot of partnerships with those in our community to make that happen.
I like our state magazine. Mm-hmm. I look in the back, and I don't see us very often in there. But
yeah, we do. There's going to be a little bit more going forward. We have to look also what we have going on, so that we can attract at the right moments. Certain times a year, we'll get more bang for our buck. But we have, you know, a lot of promotions that go are usually around our festivals as well. So we try to pick and choose what's going on so we can get that out there.
Well, we have great things every day going on in our parks and rec, and people tell us that. I know I've been on that board a while.
And yes, sir.
We hear back from the public that they enjoy our parks very much, and they come from all over.
So. And you're right, with the increase with the hotels coming up, I think that bottom line will also increase.
Good.
Thank you.
I have a little question. Mm-hmm. If somebody, suppose I owned, I don't know, a winery or some kind of agricultural maybe thing, and I was going to have an event, would I be able to call your office and say, and tell you about my event mm-hmm. and ask you to help me to promote it? Is that something that you all do?
Yes. If we find it's tourism-based, we do. We have a calendar on our website, so everything, something can be submitted on there, and it is reviewed by our administrator. If it is tourism-related, we'll post it, or you can just share the information. We'll be glad to put that up. We are also the only tool from our events calendar to the state. So every county has one representative. And so if you have an event that may be tourist-driven, you have to reach us first. And that's how it populates into the state side as well. But yes, in addition to just having that event, if individuals need assistance with research for events or for the lodging element, we have resources to assist them as well.
Great. Mm-hmm.
Briefly, and brief for your sake, can you explain the occupancy tax? What is the rate and how's it applied? Who decides what it will be and so forth?
The occupancy tax is 3%, and that was decided, I don't know how long ago, many years ago. In
1987.
Thank you. So it is 3%, and it was established that 2/3 of that would go directly to the Tourism Development Authority to market our area, and then the other third, minus there's an administrative fee in there as well. That goes to the county, and the other third is also provided to the county to distribute for the same reason.
Are there any other taxes on, for instance, somebody's lodging bill other than the any sales tax or whatever?
There is sales tax, yes.
And then the occupancy, and that's
In addition. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, sir. So every one who stays overnight is charged the sales tax and an occupancy tax.
Is that 3% uniform across the state?
No, sir. No. It does change from county to county. A lot of the counties are slightly higher. Some more rural counties might be slightly lower. But most of them, there's quite a few that are up to 6%. But we are at 3.
Seems like when I travel out of state, I see even higher, like 10.
Definitely, if you go to some of the larger cities and so forth, you can find 10 to 15%.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Next, we have our contracts, I guess, is with other agencies. Mm-hmm. Mac Williams, Alamance Chamber of Commerce.
Good morning. I'm here representing agencies that don't have Bob Bird on their
on their board.
Right. I'm Mac Williams. I'm president of the Alamance Chamber, and we are your contract agent for providing economic development services for Alamance County. What that means is that we are the agency with responsibility for recruiting new companies and employers to the county that would bring tax base and jobs, also working with existing companies here that may want to do an expansion. Beyond that, we are doing marketing to our constituency, very different from the constituency that Grace and her agency market to. We try to market to those, not necessarily directly to companies, because it's hard for us to know what companies specifically are out there that are going to be making an expansion or a relocation. So we try to market to the intermediaries. This business is very much driven by third parties who companies contract with, either realtors or consultants typically, to represent them in a site search. And those consultants will then in turn get in touch with realtors of the state, who in turn get with us. And that's how the chain works. And so we do a lot of marketing to those intermediaries, primarily through personal interaction, myself and members of my staff, staying in touch and having a personal relationship with those intermediaries. In addition to working on the recruitment and the marketing piece, the client handling piece, we do community community development work in conjunction with local governments and others who put product out there on the market. And for us, product means sites and buildings. And the more ready a site or a building is for receiving a tenant, the more competitive we're going to be. So we have an interest in trying to do what we can do to help that to occur. And then finally, the county is a significant partner on the public side. In addition to the county, we are also receiving public funds from the city of Burlington, the city of Mebane, the city of Graham, the village of Alamance, Swepsonville, town of Elon. All of those have also been our public partners throughout the process here. And then we also have, in addition to the chamber members, we have above and beyond that investors in a private economic development foundation, a 501c6 foundation. We just completed a fundraiser. We've raised about $2 million from the private sector to be a complement to the public sector funding. That $2 million would come in and be spent on over the next 5 years. So this public-private partnership seems to be working pretty well, as it has for, I've been here 13 years, and this partnership has been in place that entire time. I think we've delivered on the expectation. I think over the last 5 years, we have announced 30-some-odd projects, 32 projects, I think, on the announced tax base, or the announced investment that these companies said that they would be spending was about $500 million. They also announced over time they would be creating about 2,000 jobs. So we think that's what you've hired us to do. We hope that you feel like you're getting your money's worth, and we certainly appreciate the county's support in addition to the support we're receiving from the other public partners as well as the private sector.
I have two questions. I was confused. Would our contribution, and has our contribution gone to the chamber itself or to the foundation?
To the chamber.
To the chamber, okay. And so I get calls every now and then about why we need to provide these economic incentives for companies, with the thought being that the company would come anyways, or the companies that we're helping to expand, they would expand anyways without our assistance. Could you speak to that?
Well, I can. My answer is it's a competitive arrangement. Companies have options. Even companies that are here, when they're looking to expand, they have options for how to do that and sometimes where to do that. And incentives has evolved as a way, as a tool that local communities have engaged in to try to enhance a competitive edge that they might have, or to mitigate a challenge that the company sees as being an issue for that location. Companies that are in these modes of investing in a new location or expanding in an existing one, time is their enemy, uncertainty is their enemy, and what companies and communities are trying to do is to try to reduce the barriers to these companies for making for getting on the ground, getting up and running, and getting their return on their investment as quickly as possible. And so the communities that are prepared, the communities that respond aggressively with incentives, are the communities that win projects more often than not. Communities without incentives are communities with limited incentives or no incentives. In our world, in an Alamance County type of world, that's a very there's a lot of communities like us out there, communities that are good communities, but they ring urban areas. Somebody looking to be within 50 miles of an airport, within a half an hour of an interstate, with a good labor force, good parks, recreation. There's a lot of communities out there, not just in North Carolina, but South Carolina, Georgia, Tennessee, Virginia. Those tend to be the areas where we compete when companies are looking. Very unlike not to belabor it, I'll end here, but when a retail store, for example, is looking for a location, they won't demographics work in their favor. If the demographics aren't there, typically for a retailer won't come no matter what the incentive is, because their market's not there. But if the market is there, then that's the incentive for the retailer. Then the retailer wants to know, I want that corner right there. So there's a very specific market and a specific location a retailer will tend to look for their to deliver what they're delivering. A manufacturer might look at it a different way. They can be within a 250-mile circle of a market that they want to serve. And so then they're looking for the best place within that 250-mile circle to get up and running quickly, to make a profit, to operate profitably. And that's a lot of counties in a 250-mile circle. And so they have their choices. And so for us to be competitive, we get in the game very, very often because of the inherent advantages we have here of our location, our two interstates, our proximity to two metropolitan areas on either side of us, the quality of life element that presents itself. So just by our inherent where we are in the world, we get a lot of looks. But the real estate issue comes up. So, but still, there are other nice places in the world who have a lot of stuff to offer, and it gets down to at the very end, what else can you do?
So the
incentives are important. They don't start off that way. They usually are the last thing to help a community differentiate itself from its competitors.
Well, the proof is in the pudding, and we've had a lot of success.
Yeah, I think part of that is due to the collaboration we had, like at North Carolina Commerce Park.
That's right.
Where we had county, two municipalities come together to make something that puts it out there where somebody looking, they say, oh, we can move quickly, which, like you said earlier, they're looking. Once they make that decision, they want to go have their building up next week.
Lidl would not have come if the Walmart project had not occurred. And now that Walmart and Lidl have occurred and all the stuff that's happened out there, the roads, the water sewer, all of that, then pressing it came along.
I think we're doing something right, because one of the magazines you showed us a while back, a national magazine for people in manufacturing and so forth, mentions Alamance County with envy somewhat.
We're a small county, relatively speaking, but right. We've been successful relative to our peers. Yep. At least the last 5 years, we need to keep it going. And that's why I'm here.
And that's why you're here.
Yeah. I had a couple of questions. We're asking for $125,000 this year. Is that an increase?
It is not. In fact, $125,000 has been the same number we've been asking for since this relationship began, even with the other public sector partners involved. $125,000 has been the number, and it was the number we got for 2 or 3 years, and then there was a period where the county started cutting back, and they cut back all of the outside agencies, and we were wrapped into an outside agency, even though we have a contract to provide a service. So we were wrapped into that, and we took our lump and have had a lesser amount come to us for many years now. I think 116 or 117 has been what we've gotten. We keep asking for the same original amount because we're getting the same original amount from the other public partners as well as from the private sector. So we continue to ask for the original intended amount from the county, but it's an increase over what we got, but it's not an increase over what we've always been asking for.
Mm-hmm. I just wanted to say, I get asked occasionally too about the Chamber of Commerce and why are they part of the county budget, and I explain to people that we don't have an economic development officer or an economic development office in the county, and so if we had that part of county government, then we would be paying that salary, probably an assistant, office space, equipment, a car, and all of those other expenses. And so I think that this is a good investment for the county, not only in the return, but also in not having that being an office that is staffed by a county employee. So I think we should appreciate that. Also, I had the opportunity to go to my training that's required of county commissioners and met county commissioners from other parts of the state. And they said, how do you in Alamance do your economic development? You know, you're getting so many companies coming there. And I said, well, we work with the Chamber of Commerce and they do a really great job. And one of them said, know, kind of got a look on his face and said, our economic development officer is retiring in 8 months, and he doesn't do anything. He just comes to work and hangs out because he knows he's retiring, and then when he retires, somebody new is going to be brought on, and it's going to take them a while. And there's some frustration maybe in other parts of the state of North Carolina with the lack of traction, which I think absolutely, thanks to your efforts, we have that.
Well, thank you. We have a good product to sell inherently without the incentives. Incentives can't make a bad deal good, but they can make a good deal better. And I think that's when we're offering incentives, we're making already a good deal a better deal.
Do you happen to know, or can you speak to the value of the property tax paid by a business? I understand that, for example, for every dollar in property tax that is paid, that industry requires less than a dollar in services from the government, and residential requires more than a dollar in services from the government. Do you happen to know those numbers?
I do not. Anecdotally, I have heard what you have just said, right, as well.
I think the Farm Bureau group has put some numbers.
And there may be some economist that has done that research, but I don't know those numbers. But I agree. Yeah. I've been at this a long time, and I've, over my entire career, I have heard anecdotally what the point that you just made.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Thank you, Mac, very much. Appreciate it. All right, Alamance Rescue Squad. Kyle Buckner is not here. He's in the overflow. Okay, we'll wait on him then. How about that?
Good morning. My name is Kyle Buckner, the Chief of the Alamance County Rescue Unit. A little bit about our organization. We've been in service for 61 years here in Alamance County. We contracted with you, the Board of Commissioners, to provide heavy vehicle machinery extrication, swift water and still water rescue and recovery, canine search and rescue, agricultural rescue, and we also do high and low angle rescue. In our contract with the county, we currently get $100,000 for operating budget, which in that provides some daytime coverage because we are all volunteer, and it's getting more difficult through time for people to leave their jobs during the day to answer the calls. So 7 days a week, we have two of our volunteers that are staffed at the building for 8 hours a day, and then after that, everyone else is a volunteer. And then we put some of that money back for capital reserve, and then the rest is for our day-to-day and month-to-month operations. The only thing that was not in our budget that got sprung on me a little bit after our budget was due was, you all familiar with the county's looking at upgrading our radio system. Including that, after the budget was presented to the county, they came back with our budgetary numbers for our replacing our radios. When we originally did the replacement, or got the new 800 radios in the county, we went with a very minimum amount of our radios to get us by. And then we purchased a few as time has went on. But I would also like to request in our budget that if we replace our radios at this current time, it would be a total of $275,742.15, with an annual payment of $43,319 over the next 7 years. Now, with that being said, I have sent in a revised list of this to get a better number on these radios. I felt like that the initial amount that we sent in was a little bit much, which would actually give some of the volunteers that are out here that are not on the apparatus radios, because it is a safety issue when they're out on an incident, and before apparatus arrive, they have no communications with our 911 center at all. We only people that have that are officers that currently have radios, portable radios on them. No members have those at all. So this would actually create a better working environment for my volunteers in the safety aspect, because our call volume since 2004 has rose 115%. So that we run a lot more calls, a lot of more stuff on the interstate, unfortunately, and that's probably one of our most dangerous areas to be without a form of communications. So that's the only addendum that I had to our budget. Right now, you know, we're purchasing what equipment we can afford at time, and we'll continue with our day-to-day operations just as you presented us with that money in the past.
Didn't we go away from 800 a couple years ago?
No, we're still with the 800 with system, 800. On the Viper system with the state. So I think we've been with them probably since 08, maybe before that. I know the radios that we currently have in most county governments, 08, 09 radios.
Any question for me?
That's good. Thank you for your service there.
Thank you very much.
All right. Division of Forestry.
Good morning.
Hey, Keith. How are you, sir?
Pretty good. Since we got a little bit of rain, the fires have quit.
Wind's still blowing, though, right?
Definitely. Just look at the flag. If you'll look at the front page there, our budget has actually reduced. We're asking for $170,851 this year. We've taken the truck out of the budget for that was the reduction. We actually received the truck this week, Thursday, and it'll probably take us a month and a half to get it in service and up and running. The county's portion of that is $68,340. They pay 40% of our budget. The state pays 60%. Last year, we had a flood that washed out one of the community's roads, and since it was not a state-maintained road, they had some trouble getting access back to the houses. This affected about 100 people. If you look at, I think it's the third page, we have steel bridge mats that we loan to logging companies to get across creeks to reduce the erosion and sediment in the creeks. Emergency management asked us if we could help them out, and we were able to retrieve a set of logging mats and bridge the gap so that the residents had access and were able to get emergency access to their houses. And they actually had two calls that weekend before they were able to get the road
fixed.
Where was that? Tangle Ridge Trail?
Yes, right here in the county.
In Mebane, I think, wasn't it? Yeah. In the Mebane area?
Pleasant Grove, Pleasant Grove. 49.
Okay.
I think they kept the bridge maps about a week, but they were able to get the contractor in there and get the road fixed. But that's one of the things that we have besides our chainsaw crews, our fire trucks, our dozers. We have a lot of people and equipment that we can help in specialized situations. Our forest management has gone down a little bit since the state has started charging for management plans and have been trying to reduce the backlog on our cost share program. They have not accepted any new applications, so our numbers have gone down a little bit. Hopefully this year, once they have restructured the forest development program, they will be taking new applications starting July 1st. So our numbers should start bumping back up. On page 6, where it talks about the Envirothon, Cedar Rock Park hosted the state Envirothon competition. That was this weekend. We had 49 high school teams and about 50 middle school teams that showed up from all over the state for the two-day event. Elon also hosts the area competition for the students in Alamance County. And I think we had three teams in it this year, so we were well represented. As of Saturday, our assistant county ranger is moving on to bigger and better things. He's going to a service forester position in Lexington. So we have posted his position, and it will be open till Wednesday, and hopefully we can get somebody hired in the next few weeks.
Very good. ACC has a forestry program. Are you working with them any, or they're doing a program there in the horticulture?
I knew they had the horticulture program, but I did not know they had any forestry.
It was something they just started up in the forestry side of it.
I did not know that.
Yeah.
I'll have to make some contacts.
Yeah, call Justin then. Any questions? Keith, thank you.
Yes, sir.
All right. Other outside agencies that we have on our agenda today are Alamance County Dispute Settlement Center.
Good morning. My name is Alexi Farrell, and I'm the Executive Director for Redirections of Rockingham County and the Interim Director for Alamance Dispute Settlement Center. Since the JCPC programs will no longer continue under the Alamance Dispute Settlement Center after July the 1st, the Board of Directors was faced with a dilemma. How were they going to fund the mediation program during the next fiscal year without the cost-sharing advantages of being with JCPC? So Dwayne Flood, who was the board chair, talked to Jody Miner, who was the executive director for the Mediation Network. And Jody advised him that probably the best thing to do would be to merge with another center, which is something that the smaller mediation centers are doing across the state, because that is a cost-saving measure. And so he suggested that they merge with Redirections in Rockingham County. And that would give them one director and one finance director, which would save money, and the board agreed. So the good news is that earlier this year, when Alamance submitted their budget, they asked for $24,000, which would include the JCPC money, and that will no longer be necessary. So this time we're going to ask for
$15,000.
Now, what that funding is for our district court program. And as you probably know, many of the cases that wind up in district court are what are considered to be nuisance cases. Family members and others who get into disagreements with each other. And they take up a lot of court time, and yet mediation is a perfect way to settle these cases. So they're also perfect for people who might lose their job or who want to go to college or want to get into military service, because when they're settled, there are no convictions on these people's records. So the mediation is a successful win-win for everybody. Also, it only costs them $60, and if they go to court and are found guilty, the costs are $180. But I know that, Ms. Gailey, you said when your friends ask you, why are you funding a program like this? So we sat down and we did some thinking about this in Rockingham County, and we did a little study of what we did, and I feel like what we have in Rockingham County is also the same for Alamance. So we feel that mediation saves the county significantly in court costs. Last year, in 2015-16, our mediation program successfully mediated 305 cases. Now, if those cases had just gone to court, we looked at the criminal records of those involved in the 305 cases and determined that based on their criminal records, 125 participants would have received jail time if they'd gone to court and been convicted. If half of the 125 participants, or 63, were found guilty, they would have served 2,293 days. And based on an estimate from the Sheriff's Department, the cost of a day in jail in Rockingham County averages between $40 and $50 a day. So we took an average of that to say $45, multiply 2,293 days, and determined that our district court mediation program saved Rockingham County $103,185. So, and I believe that Alamance District Court Mediation, because it mediates even more cases, probably saves the county even more money in jail costs. During this past month, I've had the opportunity to meet and talk with the staff and many of the volunteers of the District Court Mediation Program, and they seem to be very hardworking and dedicated to the concept of mediation. I hope that this program, to which you've committed in the past, will continue to receive your support.
May I be excused a moment?
Yes,
sir.
Any questions? Anyone?
I don't think so. There's a name with this merger. There's a name change.
There will be. I'm hoping within the year we will have one name for both centers, and we will rebrand ourselves.
No, I think it's important if we can avert from going to jail or whatever. It's worthwhile.
You do the teen court program as part of your office, is that right?
No, that's part of the JCPC program.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
All right, very good. Thank you. Okay, other outside agencies. Next we have Allied Churches. This is a new request, and we have a new director at Allied Churches. So.
Yes, good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak in front of you today. During the past year, Allied Churches have provided temporary and permanent housing to over 100 families and served more than 64,000 meals in Alamance County. Additionally, volunteers from various churches, local businesses, and partnering agencies have provided an estimated 5,000 hours of their personal time to assist Allied Churches in meeting the community's increasing needs. In addition to these unfailing acts of devotion and commitment displayed by its volunteers and staff, Allied Churches partnered with 15 local nonprofit and human service organizations, including, but not limited to, the United Way, Department of Social Services, and the Salvation Army. Allied Churches during the upcoming months will also lead the charge to eradicate homelessness in surrounding counties, including Person, Rockingham, Caswell, and Chatham counties. These efforts, unfortunately, are not without struggle and sacrifice. Due to a decrease in donation, business contribution, and missed grant opportunities, Allied Churches, like the population in which it serves, is currently experiencing a financial hardship. If approved, Allied Churches will use county funds to cover operational costs, including but not limited to a portion of staff salaries, utilities, programming, and staff job-related training. This funding would be greatly beneficial because it secures the employment of the program architects, developers, and those who make the vision of the program a reality. Additionally, Allied Churches is not asking this council for a handout, but an investment. Allied Churches, with new leadership, is currently in the process of revising the organization's business practices, methodologies, and programs to better serve the community needs. Also, the organization is developing a strategic financial plan that will include, but not limited to, increasing donors' participation, applying for national grants, and establishing and reestablishing damaged relationship with community stakeholders. In closing, as the new leader of Allied Churches, I reiterate, I'm not requesting a handout, but an investment into a community cornerstone that serves and represents the dedication, devotion, and heart of the people seeking to eradicate hunger and homelessness within the Burlington community. Thank you.
I forgot to introduce you, but this is Richard.
Richard Gary.
Gary, okay. And are y'all getting ready to do an addition over there or something, or are you just?
No, sir, no, not okay. At this time.
I know you're pretty full some nights, aren't you?
Yes, sir.
All right, any questions?
I'd like to make a comment. So homelessness is a big issue, it seems like, everywhere. And I go to state meetings and national meetings, and in some communities, it's the county's responsibility to provide the shelters. And I know that one of the barriers to keeping people with mental illness out of the jails is shelter. And so And I can see where supporting the homeless shelter is consistent with our Stepping Up initiative and other things in our community. So appreciate the work that you do.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Richard.
Thank you.
Any questions, Tim? Okay. Very good. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Burlington Alamance Airport Authority. Mr. Van Dam.
Well, good morning, everyone. Commissioners, thank you for hearing us. Chairman Boswell. Hi. Got up this morning and fixed my cup of coffee and sat down and looked at some notes and thought about what I was going to say today. But sitting here hearing the presentations, it's really tugging my heartstrings. A lot of our fellow citizens are hungry, need a place to sleep. I want to just kind of open my eyes a little bit about what's going on. And I'm thankful that we have all the different organizations that are providing services to help with that. It makes me proud to be a part of this community. So thank you all for what's going on. And even heard Mac talking just now about economic development. My goodness, what we'd do without that and the services he's providing for us. Back when Honda Aero was locating in Burlington, we had to go to that grant he was talking about with the private funding and borrow some money from that to get things going until we could get into governmental funding. So it's all been good. So I guess what I'm trying to say is that the county as a whole worked together to benefit all of us. So thank you all for what's going on. So the airport. Oh, by the way, they're talking about incentives. We deal with incentives and requests almost daily around the airport, negotiating with two people right now, and sometimes I call them tire kickers because people are always coming around and negotiating with us and the other airports. But if these two people come, separate projects, each will bring a $16 million investment to the airport in aircraft. That increases tax base automatically, but I will have to negotiate some givings from the airport to make that happen, but it will increase the tax base. So that's what's exciting about how we all work together. Aviation, the airport is an economic provider to our community. It stimulates growth and connects our communities. Actually, I like to say around the world. You know, I have a saying I use sometimes that you can go out and pave 1 mile of asphalt road and you can drive 1 mile. You pave that 1 mile of airport and you connect to the world. So sometimes our Secretary of Transportation doesn't like to hear me say that, but quite true. Currently, aircraft at the airport, there's a $24 million tax base off of those. We've added about $15 million since first of the year that should go into the next year's tax base. And with these other two that I'm negotiating with, we could significantly add to next year's tax base. So I guess in some ways, I'm thinking, I walked in today thinking, okay, I'm going to say we're going to add the tax base, please give us more. And we are asking for more. But in some ways, that's our way of helping contribute to the community as a whole. So thank you for that. ITRE, I think you've all heard me say this before, but the Institute of Transportation Research and Education out of NC State University, their most recent study of the Burlington Airport shows that our economic impact to the community is $114 million a year. And so we're very excited to be able to say that. Their first study was done in 1996. Our contribution back then to the community was $5 million. I thought that was big stuff, and it was, but we continue to grow with your support. With that, our request this year is a little bit more than last year. As Mac was saying earlier, we were getting $282.5 per year for a while, and that was reduced down a couple of times, and I think it's last couple of three, 4 years, it's been 252, 255, mm-hmm. something like that. But I am asking for $292.5. I'm asking Alamance County Commissioners for that amount and also the City of Burlington for that amount. We use the funds we get from you all, both the city and county, to help us leverage federal and state funding. Our operations, daily operations, are taken care of through leasing to the different businesses on the airport, the different airplane owners paying leases. We charge a fuel flowage tax to those who dispense fuels. We see about 600,000 gallons of fuel dispensed each year, and we do get 10 cents per gallon as a tax to our people doing that. So we use your funds to leverage capital projects funding. And we have quite a list of capital projects that we're working on right now. Almost all of those are either federal or state funded at 90%. We come up with 10% matching share. So we will struggle to meet our matching shares with what we're requesting from the two of you, two organizations, the city and county. So questions from anyone?
The group that you referred to from state, what was the name of that group again?
ITRE, Institute of Transportation, Research, and Education. They're at NC State University.
Right. Yeah, that's the same group that did the study of the school capacity needs. State legislature inaugurated them in 1978, if I'm not mistaken. But how did they conclude, what did they say the airport needed to do?
What do we need to do? We need to go to the county commissioners and ask for more funds.
Be honest.
Good first step.
Be honest. On-site.
On-site. They really don't provide a direction of campus development. They take a look at what you're doing and here's the results of what you're doing. They did a study of the investment we did when Honda Aero came. A lot of people talk about they extended the runway for Honda. We did not do that. We were in the process of doing a runway extension when Honda came along. Honda chose the site, which from the time they first met with us and started looking for sites, they wanted 20 acres. By the time we got to the culmination of their request, they needed over 100 acres of property. We had just purchased a piece of property to provide fill material for the runway extension. The runway extension crossed a creek, filled up a gully. We needed 1 million cubic yards of dirt for that. So we had just purchased that property next door for that. And along came Honda looking for a site. So our agreement was you can build on that site once we take the dirt off. So that's where we needed to go to the chamber and all and front some money in a hurry. We had to borrow money from those banks that were still doing an annual $1 million repayment to each year. To front the thing, I think that was $11 million we fronted to get things jump-started, but that was how Honda came along. So they look at things like that, and they looked at that investment we did back then in the year 2014, return to the community broke even. So according to ITRE, whatever Honda contributes from here on out is a profit back to the community after the investment has been paid for at this point. So that's the kind of things. They do the studies, what are you doing? And they do that for all the airports around the state. You'd be surprised at what airports do provide some great economic development in the community. Some don't. We've been very blessed.
The new addition in Greensboro, you know, Honda has its mother plant. Mm-hmm. Then they have the other building there. How did that affect Burlington?
Well, the addition in Greensboro is, in Burlington they're building the jet engine,
right.
So the more airplanes they build in Greensboro, the more jet engines they need.
So it definitely was a positive.
So it's a very positive thing for us. In which, talking about new addition, this past year, Honda in Burlington added 48,000 square feet to their existing facility. Their build out over the X number of years and their economic development contract with us is to have a $65 million investment. They're not there yet, they're working on that. And so it's $65 million. Quickly, the return to the community, 58 cents, is give or take $400,000 a year to the county, $400,000 to the city. So we're excited. They are in the city limits. And something to remember also, I love to talk about economic incentives and returns. One thing about investing in the airport is return to the community. And we actually conveyed, after we took the dirt off of the Honda site, we conveyed that property to Honda to say they would be paying taxes. We broke that agreement out with them, so they agreed to it. So they do pay property taxes. So that's been a great thing for us as well.
Well, that deal you did with Honda is what was the most innovative business deal I've ever seen in my life. And it just shows what you can do when you think outside the box.
Well,
and that's what y'all definitely did.
And it's the support of this whole our community. Thank you. Any questions?
How many employees has Honda got?
At last report to me, they had 85.
85.
That's been several months. Their target is 235.
235.
It is. Mr. Burke.
An aircraft owner came to me and said that he doesn't want to have his plane at the Burlington Airport because he has to pay double taxes,
yes,
Burlington
sir.
And county taxes, so
yes, sir.
He'd just soon have it in Guilford County. Did you get a lot of that?
I can't say I get a lot of that, but I do hear that. I certainly do. We are, the airport is in the city limits of Burlington. So there's a 58 cents per 100 to the county and an additional 58 cents per 100 to the city. You can base your aircraft at Greensboro and pay 80.5 or 6 cents per 100. You can base it at RDU and pay 60 some odd cents per 100. So we do have a competitive, that's where it comes back to, I've got to come up with economic incentives if I can to make it work. Because, for instance, if a man has a $16 million jet he's wanting to put in Burlington, it's going to cost him an additional $50,000 per year in property taxes. So I've got to weigh out, okay, is it worth getting that addition to the tax base to come here and do what I'm doing now versus reducing his rent to me and offset it? And so those are the type of things we're doing on a daily basis. But you're correct, and I do have that problem to deal with every day.
But they also have to deal with getting to and from the Greensboro-Raleigh airports and dealing with the traffic in and out of there, and also the volume of aircraft traffic in and out of the airports. I would imagine that it's a lot easier to fly in and out of Burlington with the less volume.
Much easier.
Dealing with commercial passenger traffic.
A lot less volume. We will see an average in a year's time of approximately 200 operations per day, which is a lot less than Greensboro or Raleigh, either one. We've been very blessed a couple of times when the president has flown into Raleigh. Of course, they close an airspace for Air Force One, and they divert aircraft to other places. And we picked up several corporate jet customers because they were diverted to Burlington and said, wow, nice place, in and out quickly. And so we have repeat customers. We have a new customer that's coming to us to the furniture market each year. He's here right now. He's out of Los Angeles. So they're over two or three times a year, but we see that on a regular basis.
Are you going to build new hangars? Is that part of your investment?
Yes, we're actually we've broken ground a new set of T hangars. Those are 10 units. They will be for the small twins and the single engine aircraft. I'm heavily in negotiations on a 12,000 square foot large hangar for two different people. So these two different people have aircraft that won't fit in any hangar we have right now. So if they come, large hangar for this one, a large hangar for that one. So yes, each of those hangars are give or take $1 million a piece. So right now we're looking at $2,600,000 in hangar construction in the next 15 months.
Do you think we could get an overview of your budget to see how big is your budget?
Our budget, really, the operations side, oh my goodness, don't have it in front of me. You're looking at less than $2 million overall budget.
It's 1.7.
Okay.
The stuff that we got in the...
Yeah, Brian gave me that this morning.
Yeah, we didn't get the full packet.
And how much revenue do you get off of your providing the jet fuel and rental, hangar rental space and so forth?
Wow. I don't have the budget in front of me, but you're seeing, say, 600,000 gallons times 10 cents. So what's that, $60,000 a year off of that? And to those who may be familiar with aviation, 10 cents per gallon is a pretty high rate to charge. I don't think we could push any higher than that. And then the rentals, we have a variety of different types of rentals. Well, they rent dirt on the hangar, they rent the hangar from us, we have partnerships and hangars. But we're taking in a couple $100,000 a year in the rentals.
Do you think we could get a copy of your budget showing the income from the different sources and where the
federal
different allocations go? Yeah.
I can email it to you.
No,
right.
We didn't receive it.
Okay.
All right. Thank you. Duke, one more. Sure. Quickie, just interest. Duke still have their helicopters out there?
Oh, yes. So, Duke, the Life Flight.
Yeah.
So, there's a group who provides the services. And so, yes, they have a hangar there that provide all the maintenance services for the Duke Life Flight helicopters in Chapel Hills as well. So, actually, it's the company providing the services and the helicopters and the pilots in contract to Duke. And in the case of Chapel Hill owns the helicopters and pilots, but they get their mechanical services there as well. So they're there. They're talking growth. A guy met with me just recently. They're shooting for a larger hangar within about 5 years. We're excited about that. So lots of potential.
It's impressive. It really is.
Oh, thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. All right. Family Abuse Services. Tammy Smith.
Hi. I am Tammy Smith. I'm the interim executive director with Family Abuse Services, and I want to just also kind of acknowledge a few folks that are in the room. We also have our shelter director, Wendy Lewis, and then one of our board members, Anna Gail Workman, who are here today. Me being in an interim role, I wanted you guys to understand that what I'm presenting before you is an ongoing thing. It's not me coming in and just having some young whippersnapper idea. What we're talking about is, you know, I know we've been longtime partners. I was at the shelter for years before this as well, and before stepping in this role. What Family Abuse Services does is we are that person, that group, that meets people who are coming at a very traumatic time in their life. Domestic violence is one of those situations that a lot of people don't understand. It's a cycle that's difficult. It's a cycle that's difficult to break, and we're that reaching arm on a variety of ways. We've grown with the community, and we've grown fast. We now have 12 full-time employees, about 12 part-time employees, and then in addition to that, we just recently figured out for volunteers that have recorded their time, and there's a bunch that haven't, it computes to over 10 full-time employees as well in terms of just us being able to do the work that we do. With that, growing fast, we've grown fast in an infrastructure in terms of supporting those staff, in terms of supporting people. Without that, if you will, we're on a smaller budget. There's one executive director. There's no one there separate from the finances to be able to really invest in the staff, to give them that support when they're themselves experiencing the secondary trauma issues. And so we're at a critical time to kind of push forward for sustainability. We're in the process of strategic planning. And I wanted to give you guys just sort of an outline of our strategic planning process. Can I come across? Okay. So this is just.
Be careful on that cord there.
Okay. Yeah.
I don't want to make the thank you YouTube highlights. So as you can see, we as an agency, we're in that strategic planning process. We're trying to increase the budgets. All nonprofits from everywhere are being told to diversify, and we're very grant heavy. We're very grant based. And so we're trying to diversify with that. And the way that we can see doing that is by bringing on a new position, a grants manager position, that would take some of the grant management from the ED so that the ED could then invest in the staff. Then in addition to that, bring money that we haven't yet had time or infrastructure to bring into to the agency and really invest in that piece for that very purpose, so that we can create a sustainable financial plan moving forward and not just constantly sort of follow the grant vibe, if you will. One of the things just in over the years, we as an agency, we've been a team player. We're the anchor agency really in the Family Justice Center. You guys were mentioning that earlier. We participate in a number of the community groups, and then also with the Alamance Housing Committee. Our, as we're kind of creating this idea of sustainability, it's just really important. We're at a critical time with the interim role, and just now is the time. The board is active. We're moving forward with that. And so that's kind of the crux of where we are as an agency. I wondered if you guys had any questions. I also have some stats, but I know you guys have a lot of those kind of stats in that packet that you guys have as well. But just in terms of our increase in the folks coming in. That's the other piece I wanted to mention is that we have, all projections are, unfortunately, that the demand is going up. I mean, I wish we could work ourselves right out of a job, right? That would be great. But we've got an LAP program, which is called the Lethality Assessment Program, that's currently just with Burlington law enforcement, and we want to grow that. Well, that's bringing in more people, and it's bringing in high lethality situations, so that brings in a depth of work that wouldn't be recognized in just numbers, because it's going to be one client for a lot of time, and not just one client and one and done, if you will. We also have, as you know, the projections for the county are growth, right? We're supposedly one of the number one projected growth for the county. So any questions?
Well, I'll just say when I went to the National Family Justice Center Alliance Conference, mm-hmm. I learned a lot about domestic violence and and the related issues of child abuse and sexual assault and human trafficking and the whole issue about adverse childhood experiences and how that feeds into it. But all that, just to say just that I really appreciate what you're doing.
Well, thank you for that.
Your service.
I'll echo that. I appreciate what you guys do over there. It's a great service to our community.
Thank you. I did want to say, too, one of the ways that we're partnering is with the elder abuse grant that you guys have gotten. We added a position just for that very purpose of supporting that grant and moving that work forward. So we want to, it's time for us to get a little deeper and so that we can then help as a community.
Thank you.
Hi. One quickie, and it should be related. Do we know of what percentages of single-parent homes we have in our county compared to other counties? Do we have any idea?
Single-parent homes? I would not have that stat, and that would be a difficult stat, I think, for me to have, because domestic violence happens in all families.
Well, I definitely think it would be related. I mean, that's why a single parent got kicked out or moved out or got slapped out or something.
Yeah.
You know.
Right.
No, I think it's definitely related. I'm just curious what our percentages would be because it affects the whole county.
It does.
And every department.
So you requested $58,386. Is that an increase over
yes.
last year?
It is an increase.
How much did you get last year?
So last year, I actually don't have that amount with me. I believe it was
$33,313.
Mm-hmm. And that increase, you're asking for $14,344 for a 3% cost of living increase for your advocates?
Yes, and so that's no one in our agency has received any type of cost of living increase in the past over 6 years. Since I've been there, there's not been any of that. So when we start comparing our salaries for many of our advocates would be very close to what you guys posted as poverty levels.
Curious about one more question. Mm-hmm. No-fault divorce, do you think that's good or bad in the state of North Carolina?
My personal opinion?
That's why I asked.
Interesting. you know, I actually have no opinion on that, to be honest, because that not being a lawyer, not in that field. And so I don't know how I feel about that. So
being in North Carolina, I'm not sure the statistically, but I think, you know, we're one of the few that still have no-fault divorce.
Uh-huh.
Or maybe it's more of a trend than it used to be, but you know, it does lead to broken homes and easy way outs for people rather than make it work out. And I guess, you know, sometimes you need to get out. Sometimes
right.
you need to be forced to stay
right.
and work it out. And no fault divorce, it's a big debate sociologically as far as whether
right.
it's good or bad. And I just wonder what your opinion is.
Well, yeah,
I think all states have no fault divorce now.
Yeah, it's definitely probably higher than it used to be. But North Carolina at one time was one of the few that still, or that had it, and
right.
maybe has progressed to where most people think it's a great idea. Yeah.
One of the oddities in divorce law is whether it's a community property or a common common law property state, and how the property is divided. That's a big difference between like East Coast states and West Coast states.
Okay. So I guess what I would just say in speaking to that is domestic violence does happen in married homes, but it happens in people living together homes. It happens in families. It happens with elders and their children.
Sure.
So we're dealing with that cycle of someone having power and control over another individual and trying to break out of that. And that's a very difficult thing to break. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, next, Mike Nunn, I think, Link Transit.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman. Good morning. Members, it's nice to hear all the agencies and their history. As you know, Link Transit started 1 year ago, hopefully you recall. I was here in April, I believe, talking about this new transit system that our area that has not had before. So this June will be 1 year old. Last time the request was $25,000. As you hopefully recall, we were speaking specifically to a fifth route, an orange route, that before the Link Transit system was not serving the area we're in right now, downtown. with the county offices, nor was it serving the Alamance County Community College. So those funds that you put forward went in partnership with the United Way, the Community College, and the Hayden Harmon Foundation to provide the operations or a portion of the operations for the Orange Route. The route operations are about $150,000 each, so it's a percentage of that, but certainly not covering all of it. But again, the request is for $25,000. The new system, if you will, has carried almost 70,000 people through the end of March. Ironically, the stops here downtown are one of our top three stops for the system. ACC is also one of our top stops for the system. It compares with the medical center as far as volume, Alamance Regional Medical Center. One of our top requests are the Graham and County requests as far as other stops in our area. So we're very pleased. You know, it was a planning process, a projection process. This operation of the Orange Route and this stop seem to be performing as we anticipated, actually above expectations for a new system. We do operate Monday through Friday, 5:30 a.m. to 6:30 p.m. Already, before less than a year has gone by, is when are we going to extend operations? And that's probably, as you hear with most services, once you begin working, you go next. Also, we don't have service on weekends, so that's another challenge as well. But next year, we've projected the same service, the same budget, just to continue forward until we get some level of consistency in our community, because we are still educating. You know, it's a brand new fixed route service, so we want to make sure people know what Link Transit is. Hopefully you've seen the bright buses driving around, but it is a fixed route service. You don't have to call in to make a reservation, and it runs Monday through Friday, as I said. So we're still in the education phase, but the response from the community as a whole, specifically the Orange Route as well, has been at or above our expectations, and we see it growing. Every quarter it has grown. January, February, March, for example, the Orange Route has gone to the top of the five route list, and that's been through students going to ACC, both campuses, the Dillingham Center and the main campus, and as well downtown here. And I can answer any other specific questions you have about that, but I just want to give you an overview of the system today.
Well, I would like to make a comment that, and I serve, for disclosure, I serve on Mike's Advisory Commission, representing this board, we were asked to do this in conjunction with the other partners that Mike mentioned, because the city of Graham elected not to participate in the system. But it's such an important service to make sure that people are able to get to the county offices, and especially to ACC and the other important organizations that we have here in the in Graham, like the Children's Museum and the Arts Council and the Park and Ride Lot. I was on the bus. I mentioned this at a previous meeting, and the bus that I was on was an early morning Orange Route from downtown, and I got off here. But there were four people on that bus that got off at the Dillingham Center, and another that were going to the ACC main campus. So I thought, well, this is the way it ought to work. And one was getting off at the Park and Ride Lot at in Graham to get on a park bus to go to Greensboro. So I thought that was nice too, the interconnectivity. But last week I was at the Health and Wellness Summit that was put on by our Health Collaborative, which is part of Healthy Alamance, and we had a breakout session, and I can't remember her name, but she's one of the staff at ACC, she was commenting about how important, we were talking about the various attributes of our community that promotes health and wellness, and she was talking about how important that Orange Route was to ACC overall, and she's located at the Dillingham campus, and how important it was and how often it's used for students to get to school. So it's doing what it's supposed to do.
And just to remind you, students receive half rate, so they're paying 50 cent or a dollar round trip for that trip. So
any other questions, Mike? Well, I'm glad to hear at least our Orange Route is one of our top moving routes there. So, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, next we have North Carolina Symphony. Amanda, is that correct?
Hi, how are you?
Hey, how are you?
I guess afternoon now.
Getting there.
Yes. All right.
So I'm Amanda Volrath. I am the Corporate and Foundation Giving Coordinator for the North Carolina Symphony. And so I am here to respectfully request on behalf of the Symphony $5,000 from the Alamance County government in support of two music education concerts for approximately 3,500 fourth and fifth grade students in Alamance County during the 17-18 school year. Dates to be determined. The money received will go directly to pay for the musicians and the conductor's compensation, and the total cost for both music education concerts is approximately $59,000. Founded in 1932, the mission of the North Carolina Symphony is to be the North Carolina State Orchestra, achieving the highest level of artistic quality and performance standards, and embracing its dual legacies of statewide service and music education. Traveling over 18,000 miles a year, the Symphony performs for over 250,000 North Carolinians in communities large and small, both urban and rural. Specifically, the North Carolina Symphony has traveled to and performed in Alamance County for over 35 years, bringing both quality performances and comprehensive music education to adults, children, and families in this region. The North Carolina Symphony will present these two full orchestra curriculum-based music education concerts in Walter Williams High School Auditorium in Burlington for school children from 20 elementary schools in the Alamance Burlington school system, reaching students of all economic levels and demographics. In order to fully prepare students for the concert, Alamance Burlington school teachers are given the Symphony's comprehensive education curriculum to introduce their classes to the building blocks of music. The curriculum is developed each year by the Symphony's artistic leadership, a group of educators from across the state, and members of the North Carolina Department of Public Instruction. The program is designed to support the learning objectives for music for grades 3 through 5, which are outlined in the NC Standard Course of Study. Our music education concerts aim to educate, enhance, and enrich the lives of North Carolina school children. This program perfectly aligns with the strategic plan of Alamance County, and then offers a high-quality public service free of charge to all 4th and 5th grade students in Alamance County, and contributes to the vibrant culture of Alamance County. So, we appreciate the support of the Alamance County government over the past 20-plus years in bringing these education concerts to these children, and we hope that you will consider supporting us.
So, I have a comment. So we used to have a chapter, a yes. local chapter, and I was on that board for many years.
Okay.
And then I was on the board in Raleigh for a year.
Oh, wonderful.
Okay.
Chapter
president. And the work that the Symphony does is just outstanding. But I've been to a few of the concerts at Williams High School, right. and you should see that if you haven't been, to see how the kids, I mean, you have an auditorium with 1,500, 2,000 kids at it, and how the conductor engages that audience, and it's really tremendous. The preparation is obvious that the local music educators do with the kids to prepare them for that concert. Now, my wife, born and raised here in Graham, she remembers when she was in elementary school going to a concert, and that had a big impact on her going down a career of music education.
Oh, wonderful.
It really
we
did.
Hear those stories all the time.
And in my service on the board, I heard it all the time, the impact that the Symphony has had on young kids in this community and across the state.
I did myself.
So you're a musician?
Yes, I am.
Yes, okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much.
All right, we have two more requests here, and then we're going to take a short break. Piedmont Conservation Council.
Hey guys.
Hey, how are you, sir?
I'm Rudy Langley with the Piedmont Conservation Council.
Okay.
The Piedmont Conservation Council is a 10-county group of volunteers that identifies or receives projects from maybe the Soil and Water Conservation District, the Board of County Commissioners from one of our member counties for a natural resource problem that we can write grant money for and help put it in place. We are all volunteers. We do have 3 part-time employees that's what basically your dues goes toward is our employees. We can't use grant money for hiring people most of the time. This existed here in Alamance County and in the North Central Piedmont since 1968. Some of our past projects was Lake Camac, the watershed protection around Lake Camac with the embankment ponds that serve as sediment traps to keep the water cleaner in the pond or lake. Graham Mebbin Lake, Back Creek Water Quality Project that feeds Graham Mebbin Lake. We've done the GIS, the fire hydrant with the farm ponds for the local fire departments, then the GIS location so that all the fire departments that travel into a fire department zone has access to where those hydrants are. We did the wood and yard waste program in all of our 10 counties, worked with several municipalities, got them on their feet doing their own mulch program, and Alamance County was the last county that converted, and we turned our equipment over to Alamance County to continue that program. We've done farmland protection plans in our member counties. We've hired the contractors, raised the grant money to put it in place to help the county put that program in. One of our recent projects, fairly recent, was about 4 or 5 years ago with Alamance Community College. We did a stormwater plan, put in retention ponds, watered the parking lots. They had an erosion problem that was hitting the river pretty hard, washing out the riverbank and the field approaching that. The conservation district came to us, Alamance Soil and Water came to us, and we wrote the grant money, spent approximately $250,000, oversaw the project. And now we're sort of partners with ACC. We have our monthly meetings in their boardroom, so it worked out good for all of us. I will say that for every dollar we get in public funds, we leverage $20 to $100, varies from year to year, to do our grant projects. Janet McFaul, Dr. McFaul from Elon University, all of you know her, got projects all over everywhere. She's one of our volunteers, and she wants to tell you what we've got going on right now.
All right.
Okay. Unlike the other organizations, you've got two of us, because there are two Alamance County representatives on the PCC. Other projects, PCC is involved with the Haw River Trail. We're looking at new projects for water quality improvement. We just closed out a project called Beyond Farmers Markets, which was a $25,000 project funded by North Carolina Department of Commerce, connecting local farmers in Alamance County with new markets. We're working with Impact Alamance on their food collaborative to expand the farmers' opportunities for selling to institutional buyers. We're working with Wake County right now on what we call Cultivator Farm Project, which provides land for new farmers, and we have volunteer attorneys that have put together our legal documentation to make that happen. So our next target county is Alamance County. We're also currently looking for money for expanding the quilt trail from Rockingham County, Franklin County, and Person County into Alamance County. We are asking for $2,000, which is our membership dues for Alamance County to be a part of the PCC. So we are asking for you to continue our membership in the PCC. Thank you.
Very good.
Any questions?
I'm good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for what y'all do. Good work. Young musicians.
You're right.
Hey, Dad.
Let me just pass out our latest brochure. My name is Beth Bader, and I was listening to this 30, 40, 50, 60 years, and we're only have been here 2 years, and people are asking for 50 and 60 and 100 and 200,000, and we're only asking for 5,000. What we are is an intensive music instruction. We teach both general and instrumental music to children whose families cannot afford this. We recruit from the school-wide Title I schools in Alamance County, and we provide them with 6 hours of instruction each week. We're prevention. We are not intervention. We are prevention. And we are part of a worldwide network of music programs called El Sistema. We take our model from them and our principles from them. We will provide, our mission statement is we will provide a safe and nurturing environment where children will develop musical, social, and academic skills, enabling them to explore limitless opportunities. Our goal is to improve the life trajectory of students, their families, and the greater community. And there is so much research, which I will not repeat for you, but how important these services are to developing children's lives and changing their trajectories. Our kids are both haves and have-nots. They have the ability to learn. They have lots of opportunity, ability to take advantage of opportunities. The problem for them is they are the have-nots. They don't have a chance to take advantage of these opportunities. So I am not going to take up a lot of time here talking to you. I just wanted to let you know about this, that one of the thing that we're asking for is $5,000 for transportation. We want to expand into Haw River because that's a very poor school, but it's difficult for students to get into Burlington where we are. We want to expand into South Graham, again, a very poor school, but the problems with transportation. I was listening to the person from Alamance County Transit Authority thinking about the ways that we might be able to cooperate and make some arrangements, right, because it's not only that the parents can't bring them, they're so far away, but parents have to work. These parents work two, sometimes three jobs. Getting them picked up, brought every Saturday for 3 hours is a little bit more doable for them. But we also, because they are in after school, they have to pick them up from school twice a week. And so we're finding things like the family has to move because the kids might be taken out of the home, and they need to be in this program because one, in particular, this child is gifted, and if she goes into another home, she's gone. She's gone. And so we want to make sure that we serve the kids. We started out with 8. We now have 42. We feel pretty good about that. But we know that there's a whole lot more possibilities here, and we want to be ready to meet them. So thank you for listening to me. It was a pleasure being here. Sort of, I had stage fright.
You did well.
Bob, you got,
I'm not on her board.
And your wife.
But no, I've been to a couple of their performances, and it's very heartwarming to watch these kids perform. And the kids that you're working with now, the 42, I think you said, they're mostly from which schools?
The largest majority are from East Lawn. Mm-hmm. They were our first kids, and their parents have really, really responded. We also have students from Newland and from Andrews and from North Graham. And what we want to do in August is do another big recruitment of first graders, because we find that those are the kids that have the most dramatic responses to this kind of opportunity. They get to play a violin, and nobody else in the school in their grade is playing a violin. So they're very excited about that. I do also want to add that we were invited to sing for the Alamance Achieves launch. And we, these first and first through fifth graders who had never been on a stage before, well, some of them had been at the Arts Council in the summer, but anyway, little first graders with the fifth graders, they just walked right up on the stage like they had been there for all their lives. It was just beautiful to see. And it's wonderful. They eat lunch together every Saturday. And first through fifth graders in the same room, and they're sitting there and they're talking to each other, and they're from different schools, so they're learning about different kids, and it's very heartwarming to be a part of. So I hope that you will, if not consider us this year, be prepared.
I ask you a question. Are you familiar with the Penn Center in High Point?
I am not. But we are. One thing I did forget to say: we've started discussions with the Greensboro Center, and they are going to come and do a master class for our students on the 13th of May. So we're reaching out to lots of different possibilities.
They took
and
an old.
Tell me more about this.
Well, they took an old high school in probably one of High Point's worst areas. As a matter of fact, it's considered to be in little High Point, Harlem. Now, I'm serious.
Wow.
They speak, it's in a bad socioeconomic neighborhood.
And that's very common in the sustainment. They go to all kinds of horrible neighborhoods.
Right.
And
John Coltrane,
them,
the jazz sax,
sure. Mm-hmm.
That was where he went to high school.
Uh-huh.
And they've turned it into an art center, and it's amazing what they've done with it. And people all over Guilford County with various talents go there for music, and of course singing. They go to Weaver in Greensboro. But what they've done at the Penn Center, P-E-N-N.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
That's good.
I will definitely look that up because these.
If they hadn't converted that into what they did, it would have been bulldozed years ago.
Sure,
and
sure.
It's an amazing project.
Well, we don't have that kind of capital just yet, but these are the kinds of connections that we are always looking for. We are not setting up territory that nobody should advance into. We are setting up connections and partnerships. So thank you very much.
I had something to say.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry.
You don't want to make me talk anymore.
Sure, I can tell.
No, that's fine.
It's hard sometimes. I just wanted to say, I feel like I wouldn't be doing my job first I want to say, it sounds like you have a great organization. I can see your passion, and it sounds like y'all are doing great work. I just, you know, as a county commissioner looking at the budget, have to think, you know, if I had a visual arts program in Alamance County that was reaching out to disadvantaged youth, or if I had a performing arts program in Alamance County that was reaching out to disadvantaged youth, I would not, I would feel I don't know, I find it interesting if one arts type got preferential or a closer look from the taxpayer purse than other groups. And so that is sort of, I'm not saying this directly so much to you as I am to the community, but I think that's something that we need to be sensitive about when we're doing a budget from public funds, is mm-hmm. that things should be as broadly based as possible and not narrowly targeted to benefit one relatively small group.
Well, I can understand that concern, but the thing that I have to say back is that this music instruction has been shown to improve, even remodel, the brains of little children. And I don't think that any of the other arts are doing that. But, you know, there's room for us all.
Oh, I'm sure there's great
benefits
to music education. I also feel pressed upon me to mention that, you know, when we're talking about budgeting public funds, we have to think about the core essential functions of government are those that have the highest priority, and the further you get from a core function of government, then maybe the less priority that would receive. And so while I very much respect your work and think it's very admirable what you're doing, and I'm sure you are seeing great benefits, that looking at the picture of all the different uses for the taxpayer money, that I would just caution the public.
Well, I'm
to consider that.
I personally feel that the sense that, for example, legislators and congressmen have, that music is a frill, is very, very short-sighted. And I can't do more of the arts or other things. We are going to send two of our children to the arts program at the Children's Museum. But there is space for them to develop as well and then to come. And I'm not asking for a huge sum of money. I'm asking for a very small piece of it. And you know that the other folks here are focusing on one particular project that they're working in, but that doesn't exclude anybody else from coming and asking for funds. So I just a thought, I understand where you're coming from, and those are my responses to your thoughts.
Okay, well, if I hadn't expressed my thoughts, you couldn't have responded to them, so that works out great. And I want to re-emphasize that I do respect what you're doing, your work, and the points that you've made.
Okay, thank you very much.
I'd like to just...
respond
to the rest of the board that a lot of the visual arts is, well, a lot of what we would fund the Arts Council, Alamance Arts, would apply to visual arts as well. I mean, that's a big part of their program is visual arts.
Okay. Thank you, Beth. Okay, that concludes everyone that we had on our list of outside agencies. I want to thank all of you for coming today, and I think we're going to take a real brief recess of my leg.
Can I tell one, please?
Go ahead.
Please. And I want to address this to my buddy back here from the sort of piece. You know, we can all do, even if it's just individual, casual comments to people. I do driver's ed. It's the best thing that ever happened to me. I love it. Keeps me going. It's my new family. It has been for 15 years. I get kids in my car all the time, and they have a big drama program at the school I work with, and I carry a box of Barter Theater brochures in my trunk, and if I find out they like drama of any sort, they get a brochure. And a funny story, one day I had a guy in my car from Grimsley High School, and his parents were into acting downtown. And I asked him, had he ever heard of the Barter Theater? And he said, no. And I said, I bet your parents have. So he got back in the car one day. And I told him, I said, do you know what the word barter means? He said, no. And I said, well, that's how it got its name. Sounds more sophisticated than that, but it's just down to a simple bartering system of getting in to see a play. And he said he was in class. You know, he got in the car another day, and he got in, and he said, you know what? He was in a class at Grimsley, and the teacher brought up the word barter for some reason. He said, how many of you know what that word means? He said, nobody's hand went up but his. And he said, the teacher said, well, how did you know that? He said, my driver's ed teacher told me. Had nothing to do with what the deal was, but I thought it was cute. Even on an individual basis, we need to promote everybody's talent and try to steer them in a way that they can achieve their goals.
All right. Thanks to everyone. And we're going to take about a 5-minute break and come back and finish our job. Our meeting back into order, and next on our agenda we have the budget amendment for planning and GIS. And,
Marlene is here too, but I told her she didn't have to stand up here with me if she didn't want to.
Okay.
It just made me look shorter. So we're here today to ask for a budget amendment to approve the use of up to $20,000 for purchase of a vehicle. We've actually gone together as two departments. We have enough money in our performance management fund, and according to the policy, we have to get you guys to approve it. But we're going together to basically purchase a car together. We're probably going to have a letter between the departments so that we work out how we're going to use it internally. But in order
Can you charge rental from one to the other?
I don't know. But we think it'll be a pretty efficient arrangement.
What type of vehicle are you?
We're looking at a Toyota RAV4 four-wheel drive. We wanted something enclosed so that we can carry materials because maps and
right.
things that don't need to get wet. but we wanted the four-wheel drive so that we can have access to some of the areas that we go visit for code enforcement, and like the road that you heard about that washed out, we went out there as well.
Okay. Questions? Yeah. I'll entertain a motion to pass this.
I'll make that motion.
Thank you, Amy.
I'll second it.
Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All right.
Thank you.
And the War Memorial donation. Yes.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. Before you is a pass-through grant that the county has received from the Alamance Foundation to be forwarded to the Alamance War Memorial, and this will be used for the cleaning, maintenance, and care of the memorial located here in Graham. It's $1,500.
And who's been doing that maintenance?
It comes from the committee themselves, and they're a separate entity from the county, but they oversee that there are flowers placed there and that it's kept clean.
And Graham, does Graham contribute to that at all? Or?
I think the committee pays for the pressure washing, but I know Graham manages the median and all the trees and stuff
around. Oh, okay. All right, very good. Questions, anyone? All right.
I'll move approval.
Thank you, Bob.
Second.
Thank you, Amy. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
And next on our agenda today, I put for Clyde to maybe update us on a few legislative bills that are in the process right now, and kind of impact to those, too, to the county.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. We've crossed over. About 1,000 bills didn't make it, 492 did.
I'm not going to go over all 492 today.
I'd like to start with Senate Bill 594. It's a child welfare bill recently introduced, which is going to significantly change the relationship between state and counties in administering social services. It's a very complex bill, so I'm going to ask Susan to you give us her concerns, since she knows more about this than I can tell you.
Sure. So Senate Bill 594 is about 13 pages. As Clyde said, it's pretty complex. So the bill has 8 parts. The first part deals with the relationship between the state, the counties, and social services. And the rest of the bill has some great child welfare plans and transformation and framework that I support wholeheartedly. The first part of the bill is a regionalization of social services. So we would go as a state from a social services in every county to a regional approach. And the current number that we've seen, that the legislation says 30 DSS admit regions. I've seen another document that says 35. But I just want to point out a couple of issues of concern with that, just that first part, because the rest of it aligns with just good child welfare practice. I think the first thing I'd like to point out is that, you know, there are many community initiatives and community safety nets that are derived by your local social services involvement. We are that safety net, and we do lead many, many community initiatives. I'm sure I don't have to point out to you what happened with the regionalization of another human services system, our mental health system, and how the needs of this community are not served as easily and as a priority with a regional approach. It does have a fiscal impact that hasn't been studied yet. You may not know it, but the county receives funding for internal service departments through our indirect cost plan. So, you know, we pay some of MIS's expenses, we pay some of Clyde's time, all of that through an indirect cost plan. And so what would that look like on a regional basis? There are lots of questions about assets. So, you know, we just purchased last year 5 Priuses, this year 5 cars. You know, whose asset does that become? How do you pay for your services? What does resource allocation look like? You all have funded social services to meet the needs of our community. Another county that we might be in our region might not have funded it at the level that you have, and we have to then allocate resources that Alamance pays for to cover other counties. So I want to raise that issue. There are there are lots of concerns, and there's been lots of discussion about whether this one section of the bill could be moved into a study, because this is a pretty significant change, but that hasn't gotten any traction yet. So this bill's passed Health Care Committee. It was not, did not have to go to crossover because it contains an allocation. The bill says by January 1st, 2022, there'll be 30 DSSs in the state of North Carolina.
The Association of County Commissioners has this on their radar screen, and they'll probably be asking us for a resolution.
Study it a little bit more. I'm on the board of the association. Not tooting my horn or anything, but just that this, I was at the meeting week before last, and it was also talked a lot at the Health and Human Services Steering Committee. And at the board meeting, the executive director of the association got an earful from the county commissioners around the table in bringing up the things that Susan just mentioned. And so I don't know if the association has taken an official stand, but it's, I think it's still being formulated. But it is, it's a pretty serious thing, really, when you think about it.
And so I want to say I'm speaking as your DSS director, not representing any association, but my director's association and the board of DSS association is in negotiations with the bill sponsor to move this regional piece to a study or something, regionalize some support from the state. And we have had one meeting and we have another one this week, but the bill is moving pretty quickly and has bipartisan support.
Who started the bill? Who's the sponsors on it?
Senator Barringer?
Tamara Barringer. Right. And so Bob's not on the DSS board. Mm. I'll just tell you that. But the DSS board did endorse a resolution. Just concerned about the part one and still, supporting the rest of the bill.
Where's Tamara Barringer from?
Wake County.
This just strikes me as being an example of how people from towns and cities don't understand rural people and their problems with transportation and getting services. Because, I mean, if the services are regionalized, then it just puts more burdens on people, say, from Caswell, Person, Rockingham County, to be able to get to population centers where they can get the goods and the things that they need, the things that have provided for them by the state.
Now, the bill does have a provision that there will be a presence in every county, but we don't know what that looks like. That could be just an intake unit. Yeah. It could be that would be worked out by a work group that's defined in the bill. So,
thank you,
Susan. I'd be glad to answer any other questions.
Thank you, Susan.
Next bill that with some interest is the Senate bill to allow counties to publish notices online that passed and went through crossover. Now it's going to be in the House's hands to pass Senate Bill 343. What that will do will allow Alamance County and other counties to use their website to publish our legally required notices in lieu of publishing them in a newspaper. And from my department, when we foreclose on a piece of property, we have to publish twice. Most times we publish notice to get to the unknown heirs. And then when we have our notice of sale, we publish. And that averages around $300 to $400 per notice. So you're looking at $800 that we could save by publishing it on our website. Times however many we've done, I think probably 40 or 50 this year. So not an insignificant amount of money. So we'll see what the House does with that. Impact fee legislation is
coming. Can I ask a question about that real quick? Sure. So you don't pass on that, you don't add on the cost of the newspaper publication to the tax bill, so if the taxpayer comes in to redeem, then they do have to pay that.
They do.
Or if somebody buys the property at auction, they have to pay that.
They do, but if we do something like this and we establish a fee for advertising, then we won't be charging $385 to run an ad on our website. It'll be somewhat less than that, I would think.
Just to clarify that that's not actually, in many cases, that's not money that actually comes out of the taxpayer's pocket.
Well, the it comes out of the property.
The delinquent.
The ones that are struggling to pay it for, or otherwise they wouldn't.
So it might make it a little easier to sell a piece of property too, right, if you don't have a $700 or $800 advertising fee on it. Might make a difference.
And I have just, while we're on the topic of tax foreclosure, I heard someone say recently that when you buy a piece of property at a tax foreclosure sale, you're not actually buying the property, you're buying the lien on the property. Is that true, Mike?
No, you put the property as is, where is, lien free.
Lien free.
Right.
So if there's any personal property on the real estate, then that belongs to somebody else. You don't necessarily get the personal property.
We're just foreclosing on the real property, ad valorem real property foreclosure. Now you can't get title insurance for it.
Right.
A lot of companies will not write title insurance. But that can be resolved by selling it to someone else.
And once second you have a person
chain,
in line
create a
can't
chain
get
of
that.
Ownership,
yeah.
They can get title insurance.
I just wanted to clarify that there is no misunderstanding. When people buy a property at a tax foreclosure sale, you're getting that property.
That's all you're getting.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. The impact fee bill is House Bill 406, and it seeks to eliminate the local government authority to impose all impact fees. The Orange County representatives and some other folks have been debating that robustly, and so we'll see what the Senate does with that. Another bill that interested me was House Bill 305. It's a bill that addresses and limits the school board's ability to sue the county.
So that,
it eliminates the school board's ability
their
to sue the county.
Their ability to sue us.
To sue us. Right. Yeah. Over funding disputes. So, the legislation would mandate that absent mutual agreement between the county and the school board, the county commissioner's decision would be final.
Does that include underfunding concepts?
Any reason that they may want to sue you as a board, that would be eliminated.
Who was the judge that seemed to get excited every morning about telling school systems to sue?
I know some judges.
Yeah, Manning. Yeah.
What
Howard,
a judge. Manning.
Howard Manning was, yeah, was one. And Howard's a personal friend of mine.
Oh, my Lord.
Interesting person. Very interesting person. Retired now.
Good.
Clyde, was there not a dispute settlement provision in that bill?
Yes, there is.
If you couldn't come to a mutual agreement.
If you can't
agreement.
Come to agreement. And we'll see what the Senate bill does. They made it through crossover, though, so we'll see what the final sausage comes out of the machine down there.
I think the current statute requires mediation.
It does, yeah.
Right. There's another House bill that passed. It's called the Bright Futures Act, which would authorize counties to lease components of wired or wireless network and operate network facilities to support intergovernmental services only. So, it would allow city and county center into a public-private partnership, which could include tying people into our county government web and television system. There's another bill that made crossover that is House Bill 507 that limits county zoning authority. Of course, we don't have to worry about that now, Lance County. We don't
it's
have
past
that.
Us.
But I thought it was very interesting that this would allow landowners to bring land use and zoning challenges directly to Superior Court and not go through the Board of Adjustment. So that's something
crazy
that I think the Association of County Commissioners are looking on as well. They passed House Bill 306, made it through crossover, which modifies E-Verify, which will now require all contractors, wouldn't limit it to people that have 20 employees or more, but all contractors will have to comply with E-Verify, which may make it hard for some to bid on government projects, because if they have one person, they have to comply. There, of course, the governor signed the legislation, House Bill 13, which was a compromise, giving school boards flexibility in the coming year to meet new requirements for reducing class size. What the law did was didn't fix it for future years, so the legislature's going to have to visit it again.
That's but just a one year?
It applies for the school year 2018-2019. Mm-hmm. And so it's going to have to be redone. House Bill 704, distribution of local sales taxes, is a very interesting bill. Senate Leader, Majority Leader Brown, several years ago, came up with a formula to tweak the portion that local option sales tax that communities get, and it's a hotly contested issue. So we'll see what that bill results in. It may be that Alamance counties will stay the same, maybe that our share will go up or down. Just depends on how they come up with a formula. There also were some bills that redefined low-performing schools. I don't know if you're interested in that bill. The police body camera review video bill, which has been in the news recently, that's House Bill 797, would purport to give city and county managers, but not commissioners, the ability to view police body cameras and dashboard camera video. And the lawmakers considering this said that they can't trust council members and commission members to keep it quiet. They actually said that in the debate. That made it through crossover. House and Senate passed an immigration bill. Very interesting immigration bill. It's House Bill 113. I'm sorry, Senate Bill 145. Senate Bill 145 creates a process by which any person can allege that a local government is not in compliance with state immigration law and file a form with the state attorney general's office, and they will investigate. And if the AG's office determines that the county or city is in violation, they will lose for 1 year all proceeds from beer and wine sales, video programming, telecommunication services, scrap tire disposal, those type things. The point of that is to alleviate or reduce sanctuary city ordinances or policies. House Bill 113, Private Action Local Compliance Bill, passed the House, made it through crossover. It creates a brand new right for private residents to sue a county or a municipality in Superior Court, alleging the government is not complying with immigration laws. The bill states the court shall award the prevailing party attorney's fees and court costs, and put a fine on local government of $10,000 a day for failing to comply with any order from that action. So that could cut both ways. Of course, you can't control the sheriff. But if the sheriff, if someone accuses the sheriff of violating the immigration law, they can sue the county under this bill. If it passes under law. And I've already mentioned E-Verify, and I think that's all the ones that made it through crossover. The only one of any significance, I think, that is a class size, which Governor Cooper signed on April 27th into law. So that's the update.
Thank you, Clyde. Yes, I know those are important, especially in a crossover session. At least we can have a voice with whatever house it's in down there. So. All right, next up, County Manager Report.
The only thing I have to say is May 15th meeting, we're presenting the manager's recommended budget, and that meeting is at 7 o'clock here in this room. So.
Okay,
very good. Yeah. That's all I have.
Can we get a little more condensed version of what we heard today as far as maybe the agency, what percentage of increase, and what whether it was your first time or whatever, and just single item list. I don't think we have that in the budget.
Not really. It's not broken down like that. That's a good idea to do that.
I'd like to see that.
Because we do have some new agencies requesting and so forth.
Sir.
I got to tell you this. I got a text from Bill at 11 o'clock.
That rascal.
And I texted him back, we're listening to budget request. He didn't respond.
Yeah.
Can I ask a question? When are we planning on a budget hearing? Are we
June the 5th.
So the first meeting in June.
We'll ask at the May 15th meeting that the board approve switching the two June meetings. So the June 5th meeting will be at 7 o'clock. Normally that'll be a 9 a.m. meeting. So we ask you to consider moving that to 7. So you have a budget public hearing. And we would also ask that be moved to the historic courthouse. Then we'll have the June 19th meeting will be at 9 a.m.
Switch. We've got to switch.
All right.
Meeting.
All right. And then it's likely that we would vote on the June 5th meeting.
We'd hope so.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'd like to request that this board not wait to the last minute to make a decision without doing a lot of homework going in on some of these requests, and I want to talk about the schools just for a moment. Amy brought up some good questions at our budget meeting and so forth, and I hope we'll all do this. I did this on my own, and I did it. I do it every time I look at the budget. But we're always, it's always said to us, we need more money like Guilford and Orange for world-class education. And I've always had a belief that money doesn't turn the trick necessarily. And if you take Orange and Guilford and take Randolph and Davidson, which they hate these comparisons, and you look at DPI's school report, 15-16 report, I think that's the last one. They've broken down the end of grade test into levels, and I want to get some explanation later as to why they did that. They used to look at everybody together and then give a percentage of proficiency. Now they're breaking it down into five levels. And it's pretty obvious to me, at least to me, that levels 3 and 4 are the key levels. This seems to be the average students in 3, the best they can come out with some average distinction. And then the next level would be those looking to go to college. There's 12 comparisons, in my opinion, here looking at it. They've got biology, math 1, English 1, then they've got biology, well, that's in English 2, and so forth. And then there's 12 matchups, and the school system's funded much less than ours per pupil, literally millions of dollars, millions. There are 12 matchups. Davidson and Randolph beat us in 10, ties in 2, basically ties. There's no trend for improvement based on money. If you go over to Guilford and Orange, where they have a ton of money per pupil, there's no trend at all, except we beat them in some, they beat us in others. It's just a toss-up. But the trend clearly is on the other side for money doesn't do it versus money will do it. And I think that's a distinction we all have to look at, whether we agree with it or not, or feel like, you know, we still need to pump in more money. But anyway, all this is on, this is separate from public school form, which is another set of statistics on, based on our effort, ability, relative effort, and so forth. This is coming off of DPI's website, the report cards. And I would challenge everybody to look at the report cards, look at the percentiles of successes. And not only that, but success and turnover rate. One of the lowest turnover rates in the state is at one of the lesser funded systems. And they're right beside Forsyth, they're right beside Mecklenburg. They could easily, the comment is, oh, well, everybody goes to Guilford, everybody goes to Durham. I mean, I think the Durham comparison is laughable. But, you know, other systems can go elsewhere, too, and they don't. And they have lower turnover rates. So there's a lot to look at. And I hope we'll all, whether you agree or disagree, don't wait to the last minute, please, to make your decision. Go in well-read, highly informed, make your vote. But I don't think I've distorted that in the least. No. Look at Davidson, Randolph, Orange, and Guilford, couldn't be more of an extreme comparison as far as what money's doing versus not, if you want to say money's doing it at all, good or bad.
Comments?
Thank you, Tim. I'll do that.
Please do.
I just wanted to echo what Dan Danieli said earlier. Sitting here listening to all these presentations kind of gave me a real sense of, I don't know, gratification that I live in the county that I do with all the things that are going on here. Sometimes we forget the resources that we have that impact the quality of life and the organizations that provide safety net services, and a lot of things kind of makes me feel good about being here.
And all the boards.
I don't know how many hours you get in your days.
Well, some of those I'm not on anymore, but...
Comments, Amy?
Well, just one thing. Yeah, Mr. Sutton, I think that's really good to look at the school report cards, and I've done that over time as well. And That's one of, been one of my frustrations with trying to look at the Department of Public Instruction website and trying to put together, where are we even? And what's even going on? Because you have to sort through so much data. I mean, people make a lot of money a year going through data and trying to figure out these kind of things. And that's one of the reasons that I'm pretty adamant that I think that our school system should be more transparent about, from their standpoint, what do they think are the important goals, or what do they think are the important measurements, and then set some targets for those measurements so that the taxpayer knows that the school system is committed to what they're saying will improve the school system, that we're getting the value for our money. The other thing I'd really like, though, I've been looking at over time, is a property value in Alamance County relative to the counties around us. Since, well, it's easy to find on the Department of Revenue's website going back to 1999. In 1999, it looks like we had a property, real property tax base of about $4 billion. And now it's about $10 billion, which sounds pretty cool. We've increased by 2.5 times in that time period. If you look at Chatham County, though, their property tax base has increased four times during that period. And I think that in addition to looking at sort of the workhorse performance of the school system, we've got to look at more than the nickels and dimes, relatively speaking, of the property tax rate, and take a broader look at how investments in infrastructure and the school system and in economic development, those investments pay off over time in higher property value. That I have the sense that, and I'm not ready quite to make this case very strongly, but I have a sense, and I would be very, very interested in your take on that as well, because you're great with statistics and you're great with looking at the numbers and so forth. I have a sense that we've kind of cheated ourselves relative to the counties around us by focusing so precisely on keeping the tax rate as minimal as possible while not maybe investing in schools over the time that maybe we could have. Now also, you know, Mr. Lashley's not here. I have a lot of respect for your and his experiences working with the school system, and I understand that over the years there's been some challenges there with feeling like money that's been appropriated hasn't maybe been used the way that it was supposed to be, and that there's some distrust there, and those are legitimate issues. But I'm very interested in the trend over time of what's happened to our property values, because, you know, if you have a $100,000 house and it could have, you know, in 1999, and now it could possibly be worth $400,000. Well, that's $300,000 that, you know, if it's your primary residence, you likely won't have to pay income tax or any tax to the federal government if you sell it and downsize. Or if you pass away, certain other things in your estate being true, then that money can pass to your heirs without taxes. And so I think that maybe we need to take a look at that as a sort of a fresh approach.
I definitely want to respond to that. What I heard you say is our taxes are too low.
No, that's not what I said.
That sounded awful like it to me. Forgive me. And I certainly couldn't disagree more. And you see, tax rates are, it's what you have to charge to get the revenue you need to operate government. And I don't think any rate numerically has any continuity as far as success or lack of success. Now, you mentioned Chatham. If you know anything about Chatham, and I would assume that you do, Chatham's increase in properties, Chapel Hill and Raleigh, coming up from the south, coming over from the east, west, whatever,
Pittsburgh,
wherever Raleigh is. That's clear. Chatham has nothing I want. Nothing. And, you know, I think that comparison is really wild. But anyway, Dr. Harrison made a reference in the paper. He did a column the other day, Sunday, and he made the reference. Plus, he said it at the school board meeting. He said, 58-cent tax rate, you get what you pay for. Now, that was a slam. And I couldn't disagree with him more. And then he got in the paper yesterday, and he said, your tax rate will go down if your valuations go up.
go to Guilford and see if that happened. They have a 50% higher rate than us with their evaluations being, what, three times ours. They had three times the population, so forth and so on. But I don't think our rate's too low at all. I think it's in my opinion, it's too high. So anyway, that's my response to that.
Well, I anticipate that response. And I'm not saying that our rate is too low. I'm saying that maybe we need to take a different way of looking at how do we assess whether or not our education system has, or our investment in education has translated into a financial benefit that maybe we've given up.
We still got a lot to talk about, a lot to debate.
Well, and you're right, Tim, we do. It's a challenge. Brian's going to be giving us a recommended budget, and I think he is actually looking for input from everybody, except Bill. Bill's not here today, but everybody that will be involved, and Bill will be back before we do our budget. And he'll base his budget on what we, you know, we'll work towards a good goal for everybody, and hopefully we can. I know we can't fund everybody that came today, not to the what they're looking for. And there's, it's our job now to start juggling, balancing, and hopefully everybody will participate in that part, and we'll come up with a good budget that, I'm going to tell what I told Brian. I said, everybody's going to be a little mad. Taxpayer might be a little mad. Everybody, I mean, because that's what it takes to come up with a good budget where we come together and actually doing what we're supposed to.
One more point about schools. The agency that did the airport that Danny mentioned, that's the agency that came in here and did a 10-year study. It was off by 4,000 students that they projected would be in our system 2016-17. Well, they redid their variables there and took it out to 2022. Just 2 years ago, and said that we'd have less students in our school system than we've got today, and that's a stunning comment. And if you look at their stats over 10 years, your school system has not grown.
It's kind of trendy.
It's stagnant. Yeah. It's simply stagnant. And I called a guy in Raleigh, and I asked him about it, and I said, do you still stand by it? Because in their report, they say, well, we don't necessarily believe that there's a need for a new school. They said, we feel like, if anything, there's a stretched capacity scenario with core facilities. Right. So I called him and I said, you still stand by that? And he's the guy that's in the school arena. He said, most definitely. I said, why? He said, charter schools. Exactly was his response. And I told him, I said, look, you can take a number of students and divide them by 24, 22, or whatever, and figure out how many classrooms you need. That's simple math. But what you can't come up with is a scientific thesis or analogy as to how many people are going to use a media center, so forth and so on. Because every media center I've been in, unless I don't see anybody in them. I went over to Cummings, looked at that paint scenario, went upstairs to their media center. So it's a bit
empty.
It was empty, totally empty. And I don't, you know, I think we've just got to face some facts here.
Well, I appreciate you and Bill being on that facility task force, because you've had that opportunity now to go in the schools, and, you know, that's part of.
We still got to go to Eastern, I think.
When part of what we need to do.
Next week.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to
that. Okay. Any more comments? With that, meeting adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is at 9 a.m. and the second meeting of the month is at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on Time Warner's Public Access Channel on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month at 10 p.m. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information about watching meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions regarding the content of commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can send mail correspondence to the commissioners by sending it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.